August 2016. I'm your host, Alex Jones. We're going to be live here for the next 4 hours. Coming to you from deep in the heart of Texas, Austin. If you're a layperson out there that isn't really a political insider, someone that researches how the world actually runs, and you tune into mainstream media, you would think that Donald Trump is having his butt handed to him. But Donald Trump is making a bet that the dinosaur media is so discredited with a 6% trust rate, according to the Associated Press, that you're smart enough to see through their garbage. And he's come out in a new speech today that's linked at drudgereport.com and on infowars.com. Trump, we are going to punch through the media. And I'm going to play that clip in a moment. But that's what we've got to do. In fact, I walked in this morning and I said, well, you notice Trump's come out yesterday and said that they stole the election from Sanders and that Hillary's a crook and that they're already rigging the polls and rigging the debates. And they tried to steal the election from him, but he fought back. And that it was only because he had a landslide that he was able to stop the superdelegate scam. Exactly what we put out in our emergency message to Donald Trump on Saturday. And of course, the White House run Media Matters says days after conspiracy theorists ask him to, Trump worries the election is going to be rigged. Well, it's not days after we did. He was already thinking all of this. He sees the same thing we see. But he has responded, and I'm not really going to distract into issues of whether Donald Trump listens to the show or not. Or whether or not I talk to Donald Trump, I'm just going to leave it at this. Donald Trump doesn't need me or Roger Stone to tell him all this. He knows it. And Donald Trump agrees that he's not just going to sit here and watch Hillary do this. They say 8 million less people voted with Obama being super unpopular in 2012 and that magically Mitt Romney got millions less votes, 8 million less votes than John McCain. Does anyone believe that? John McCain was a political Democrat operative. They ran as a stand-in for Obama to win. 4 years later, Obama was unpopular. Mitt Romney clearly won that election. And in 2012, guess who came out and said that? Donald Trump. Donald Trump's fighting the staged elections. He's fighting the sellout of our jobs. He's trying to overthrow the entire rotten media system. He's a bellwether of the populist rebellion that's only beginning. He can't lose, because even if they steal it from him, we win by pointing out they're criminals. Here's the clip.
The biggest problem we have is we have a very dishonest media. We have a media that is so dishonest that no matter what, makes no difference, but these are among the most dishonest people you'll ever, ever meet. These people... You know, I've had days where I said, boy, this was a great day. I look forward to seeing it tonight or tomorrow. And it's brutal. I say, what happened? But we're going to punch through the media. We have to. The New York Times is totally dishonest. Totally dishonest. Washington Post, been a little bit better lately, but not good. By the way, New York Times, which is failing, really failing badly, which is, I call it the failing New York Times. Every story they write is a hit job. I could do the greatest thing in the history of the world. I could come up with a cure for the most horrible disease in the world. And they'd give me a front page, horrible, horrible story. The New York Times is very dishonest, but it'll be out of business soon, I hope.
All right, let's stop right there. I'm going to come back and play the rest of the clip. But that's right. They're all imploding. They're already bankrupt. CNN, New York Times. They're all just become playthings of foreign kingpins and, you know, foreign drug lords. I mean, that's what they are. Every criminal, every foreign dictatorship, the communist Chinese, you name it, they're buying us up. Now, and I can tell you unequivocally, Donald Trump is the real deal, a patriot, battling the globalist and putting his life, his name, his family, his treasure, his blood, sweat, and tears on the line. Donald Trump's going with his gut. He fired his chief strategist today. And I am not going to sit here and help the enemy, help the globalist, and basically sit around and brag about how influential Infowars.com is. People can see that for themselves. It's not a pleasurable feeling, I will tell you. It is a feeling of extreme responsibility. And can you imagine the responsibility that Donald Trump feels? Trump has come out and said, we are going to punch through the media. He is making it a referendum on the globalist-run, deceptive, dinosaur media. He is coming out and saying, look, Mitt Romney got 8 million more votes, or there was 8 million more votes in that election than there was previously in 2008, but he lost. And he got less votes total than McCain. No strategist believes that. There was incredible fraud. Obama was super unpopular then. That's why Hillary's so confident. And they've had Google delist him as a presidential candidate, Donald J. Trump. They've had Twitter and Facebook restrict and ban folks exposing what's happening and promoting their right to a First Amendment and their right to support Donald Trump. We've seen the debates rigged. We've seen the time of the debates rigged. We've seen the Republicans try to come out and say, we are allowed to just ignore the popular vote and just give it to whoever we want. We might even put Paul Ryan in at the convention. But patriots, conservatives, paleo-conservatives, libertarians, Christians said, no, we're not buying this. And they had to back off. That didn't happen with Bernie Sanders and the Democrats when they stole 10 states. He was the winner. He won California. But they met the day before. Paul Watson's doing an article on this right now. They met the day before at a rich donor's house with the superdelegates and decided what the numbers would be and told the Associated Press who was there, who then put out the numbers as everyone watches at night at home with a beer in their hand at 9, 10 o'clock. Oh, Hillary's the winner projected with 90-something percent of precincts reporting. And then they have the little numbers pre-agreed with the Associated Press that releases the election numbers. Just over-the-top, Armageddon-level fraud to our republic. And then they even have a New York Daily News article about it, other articles admitting it happened. And then I talk to people on the street, and they go, yeah, I'm not voting for Hillary. I'm a Democrat. I've been canvassing on the streets. I'm going to vote for the Green Party or Gary Johnson. No, vote for Trump. And then I talked to him about, you know, Sanders really won. And they go, oh, I heard there was some election fraud. And I said, no, 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 no. The delegates just stood down and the superdelegates just announced numbers. And they go, really? I'd like to see a news article on that. I was in a store today showing a lady on my phone the articles. People know there was fraud. They don't really know exactly what happened. They're low-information voters, Democrats especially. Let's face it. We've got to get this information out to them. Mark Dice went out again, and 9 out of 10 Californians, we're not cherry-picking here. Our correspondent, Mark Dice, markdice.com, he went out and told Democrats, or people just on the street, that Trump is going to ban tampons. And they are just horrified. And, of course, some had actually heard this was happening. And that's just how horrible Trump is. You could tell them that Trump is a Martian that wants to eat your baby's brain, they'd believe it. These are dangerous people. And Trump is betting that there are enough people who are halfway sane and who do want their jobs back and who do want the globalists to take their foot off our neck. Some are saying, and we wargamed this over the weekend, some are saying, oh my gosh, if you come out and say Hillary stole the primary and Hillary's an illegitimate nominee, and if you put that out to voters, they're going to get discouraged and not go vote for Trump, thinking there's going to be fraud. And that's how the media is spinning it with the headlines like, Trump prepares to lose election. And, oh, he's a sore loser. Or, oh, he sees she's come back in the polls to neck and neck when he was 7-10 points ahead a week ago and is still ahead in most real polls. They've just put out fake polls. They admit are fake with new algorithms to show him in a dead heat. So he comes out and points this out. That's the only way to battle it. He did this 6 months ago. He did this 3 months ago when they were still trying to steal the election from him in the primary. He didn't put up with it like Sanders did. He called it as a fraud. The media said he was a sore loser. In fact, when you read this Gawker article, will you guys print me that Gawker article? It's so surreal because they quote the facts about when Trump was winning the states, but the superdelegates weren't going for him, he came out like a sore loser and complained. You see, he's supposed to just sit there and let them steal it, but he didn't sit there, so they failed. And they think they're going to have another stolen general election in front of everybody at high noon, and we're just going to sit here and go along with it. We're not. I'm going to fight it. Trump's going to fight it. You're going to fight it. And we're not going to recognize Queen Hillary if there's evidence of fraud. And guess what there is? She stole the nomination. If they would have coronated Paul Ryan as they were floating to see if you were that stupid to install him with no delegates or Ted Cruz, I would have been against him because it would have certified fraudulent elections and an end to the republic and made the parties openly dictators as they already are operating in the shadows. I would say the whole election's thrown out. Hillary has to be thrown out. Paul Ryan has to be thrown out. We have to set up new elections just like they do when it's found in other countries that elections are fraudulent. This is what they do. And they're going to act like we're doing something weird and unorthodox and never heard of. They have snap elections in Israel. They have them in England. They have them all over the place when there is a loss of confidence. They have them in Canada. If Hillary steals the nomination and then she openly is engaged in chicanery and things don't add up with Trump, you have to say it must be thrown out. And that's what Trump's preparing to do. He is pure Americana. And if he's successful, he will be the second coming of George Washington. And let me tell you, that man's in danger. Everybody should be praying for him. And quite frankly, you should be praying for us because we are now engaging the globalists at the highest levels of the arena. We've been doing that for a long time, but the enemy knows that, and they are not as arrogant as they used to be. So this is a war. Donald Trump's the figurehead, the standard, to expose the enemy media, to expose the collaborator media, to expose the foreign deep state, multinationals, Hillary Clinton, the communist Chinese spy, the spy that sold us out to Russia. What nerve they have saying that Donald Trump is an agent of Russia. He just wants to de-escalate tensions, which is what you're supposed to do. We are living in an unprecedented time. I came on Sunday. I came on Saturday. I put out the emergency report, the emergency message to Donald Trump. I said they stole it from Sanders, as you know. They tried to steal it from you. You stood up and said no. You had a landslide, so they couldn't defeat you. Trump comes out and says, I had a landslide, so they couldn't steal it from me, but they're going to try, just like they did with Sanders. Now, we're going to go ahead and play some of these rigged clips. Here he is in Ohio. Then next, he's in Pennsylvania. Here it is.
We got almost 14 million votes. Think of that. More than anybody in the history of Republican primaries. That includes some great people like Ronald Reagan, Dwight D. Eisenhower, who won the Second World War, right? He did win the Second World War. He got elected because he won the Second World War. I got more votes than him. That's good, right? And remember this, I had 17 people. I wasn't running against two people. I had 17 people. Hillary Clinton, I got a similar number to Hillary Clinton, and she had Bernie, and she had a hard time putting Bernie away. And Bernie, poor Bernie, he looked so upset. He made a mistake. He shouldn't have made a deal. Sometimes, he lost. First of all, it was rigged. And I'm afraid the election's going to be rigged, I have to be honest. Because I think my side was rigged. If I didn't win by massive landslides, I mean, think of what we won in New York and Indiana, California, 78%.
That's with other people in the race.
And you're going to hear Donald Trump more, a little bird told me, with orange hair. You're going to be hearing a lot more about this, ladies and gentlemen, because Donald Trump's not going to let you be robbed, myself be robbed, or him be robbed or his family. And Crooked Hillary thinks they're going to pull what they did on Mitt Romney. Mm-mm, lady, isn't going to happen. And that's why her campaign head, her chief strategist, said, this is dangerous what Trump's doing. You're right, it is dangerous, isn't it? Actually standing up to you, actually calling you for what you are, and saying, we're not backing down, we're not going quietly into the night. And, guess what? Everywhere he goes, they'll be in giant stadiums that are certified for 5,000. We went and looked it up, another 10,000. And they let 1,000 in and say, sorry, nobody else. And this is a guy that owns buildings, owns stadiums. He looks around and he goes, they're doing this on purpose. And they go, oh, Hillary comes in the same day and the mayor's there. She has a tiny crowd and she thanks the mayor. These are Democrat cesspool cities. Nice cities, but run by Democrat cess. Some still know what cess is. That's floating, rotting detritus. It's a sewage sludge. So let's go to the next rigged clip. Here he is now in Pennsylvania calling Clinton El Diablo.
Bernie Sanders, people all walked out. You had this mass exit. Nobody showed it. And then when they showed Bernie, very angry, they're talking about Bernie because he made a bad deal. He should have not made a deal. He would have gone down as done something really important. Once he made that deal, and believe me, he has buyer's remorse. You know, this guy has buyer's remorse. He looked at that and he was so angry when they were talking about him, and his people are angry at him, and they should be. If he would have just not done anything, just go home, go to sleep, relax, he would have been a hero. But he made a deal with the devil. She's the devil. He made a deal with the devil. It's true.
Now, I played this at the very start of the broadcast, but I want to play this full clip here, and this is history. You want a leader. You want someone to stand against the globalist. He is electronically, but also physically, marching against the Fourth of State, a captured, sold-out media that told you Obamacare was free and that there were no death panels when the bill said it would double and triple prices within 3 years, that the IRS would fine you up to $5,000 a person for not having it, and that it was written by foreign insurance companies to massively increase their profits. And they sat there and told you that I was a racist conspiracy theorist that didn't like black people on MSNBC because I didn't like Obamacare. Remember that clip? Alex Jones is deeply racist. He doesn't like Obamacare because Barack Obama's black. No, it was because I read the bill. Then we got Gruber to say, we're lucky the American people are so stupid and have short attention spans because this doubles and triples prices, and I was hired on how to spin it so we could deceive them, and Obama was very proud of me that I was the best liar. Those are quotes. Then he said that was an accident, I didn't mean it. Then they found more than 10 videos of him saying the same thing, some of them on C-SPAN. What does that tell you about their mindset? They go on C-SPAN with a bunch of other professors and statisticians and talk about how to deceive the people, and everyone sits there smiling and rubbing their hands together. This is what they've created. You go to college now and get a PhD on learning how to scam and rob everyone. Jonathan Gruber. And they sit around like the Hillary delegate going, oh, she told me we're going to get the guns. We just have to act like we don't want them and we just want reasonable restrictions. But as soon as she gets in, we're going to ban everything. They released the video within a day. People are running up to her on the street. She's running from them. This is who they are. They just sit around. I was working out with Pat Riley this morning. And he said, walking his dog yesterday by his house in Austin, East Austin, he saw a full-grown 50-year-old man with a Pokemon backpack on, like a turtle backpack, a giant turtle shell, playing Pokemon, say Pokemon on purpose, Pocket Monsters, which turns you into a Google mapping system. It's actually AI. You're there mapping. I mean, they admit that, but it doesn't matter. Just make a joke about it. Like a TV watching you. And he saw him going along. And Pat said, boy, that's who I'm competing against. It's this whole world of like, be a baby. Don't ever grow up. Just suck your thumb. They're not putting you into this position because they plan on letting you live out your life as a thumb-sucking 50-year-old male that thinks he's a 5-year-old or a 20-year-old woman who thinks she's a baby, and then sicko men are into her. This is what happens right before a culture collapses. And Donald Trump is just a archetypal thrashing death throes as we try to climb out of the molten lava and like Darth Vader and survive. I don't know if we will, but I want to salute Donald Trump for incredible courage. And I want to say this. I want to pray for Donald Trump. In fact, I was praying for him this morning. I was praying for this country. I was praying for my family on my knees, but it was so spiritual and real this morning that I intended to do it on air, but I don't feel it right now. I feel sincerity, but not like I felt this morning, total connection. But as soon as it hits me today, and I think it will, I'm going to say a prayer on air. It might be just in the middle of an interview. I don't know. But, man, I tell you, just thank God that I'm not one of these deceived people. Thank God I don't want to be part of the murder of innocence. Thank God I don't want to be part of the human-animal splicing chimera programs. Thank God I'm aware of what's going on and not part of the enemy's camp. Oh, that's really what matters here, is our souls and our integrity and who we are. Don't be discouraged if they steal it from Trump. He's not going to go along with it. This is going to be a great awakening. And he said, the New York Times, you're done. CNN, you're done. They're already bankrupt. They're already propped up by mega banks that get unlimited trillions from the public. And people ask, well, then why are they still there? They have to have the facade going so that people don't realize that it's a tiny minority that even support this new world order. I can't find Hillary supporters. Unless I go to the richest area of Austin and then I see her signs. They don't exist. Leanne couldn't find anyone on the streets of L.A. who was for Hillary. They were all for Sanders or Trump. The majority for Sanders. She went and did an exit poll. 8 out of 10 coming out said they voted for Sanders. But Sanders lost. And then we have them admitting they met the night before with the AP, with the super PAC people and the super delegates, and decided what the numbers would be and what Sanders would get and what Hillary would get, not what the. And we have the super delegate from California saying months before in New Hampshire, we'll decide what Sanders gets and we'll decide what Hillary gets on a power trip, arrogantly admitting it, just like Priebus on TV saying we don't care about the votes. So we're going to put together the informational videos that have all these people talking and bragging, and then cut to Trump saying they're going to rig it, and then cut to the media, we're taping it today, making fun of Trump saying it's rigged. We're going to show you them admitting it's rigged. Then we're going to show Trump saying it's rigged. And then we're going to show them saying he's crazy. I'll tell you, quite frankly, it's scary to see other media outlets and other groups don't even know how to fight this. We do. I wish everybody else knew how to fight it, because I don't like being the one right up front, tip of the spear, with the White House looking right down at me. Going, we need to shut this guy up. We need your prayers. You better believe it, just as much as Donald Trump does. Let's go out with him declaring war on the enemy. Donald Trump, we salute you. Here it is.
The biggest problem we have is we have a very dishonest media. We have a media that is so dishonest that no matter what, makes no difference, but these are among the most dishonest people you'll ever, ever meet. These people, I've had days where I said, boy, this was a great day. I look forward to seeing it tonight or tomorrow, and it's brutal. I say, what happened? But we're going to punch through the media. We have to. The New York Times is totally dishonest. Totally dishonest. Washington Post, been a little bit better lately, but not good. By the way, New York Times, which is failing, really failing badly, which is, I call it the failing New York Times. Every story they write is a hit job. I could do the greatest thing in the history of the world. I could come up with a cure
for the most horrible disease in the world, and they give me a front page horrible, horrible story. The New York Times is very dishonest, but it'll be out of business soon, I hope. It'll be out of business soon. It will. Really dishonest reporters. Not all of them, but most of them. And CNN, boy, to CNN, it's like all Trump all the time. All Trump all the time. You walk out of an interview, you said, that was a good interview, and then you get killed for the rest of the weekend. I tell you, they are so biased toward crooked Hillary. You know, they call it CNN, Clinton News Network, okay? CNN, Clinton News Network. Totally dishonest.
All right, there's more. It's on Infowars.com. I'm going to come back and lay out the battle plan to defeat these people. They can be defeated. We have a major opportunity now. The communist Chinese government is officially announcing that they may strike the United States at any time, and they've gone directly to a war footing that is only one click of the dial from an actual launch protocol. They have the ICBMs, the cruise missiles, the guidance systems, the MIRV technology, the boost systems, the reentry systems, everything from the Clintons. I actually think this could be a setup sneak attack. This country's going to go under judgment, and quite frankly, maybe we deserve it, because there seems to be no end to the evils that this nation will put up with. The country is struggling, trying to get out of the boa constrictor-like hold that the New World Order has on us. But if you're not praying every day that the scales be lifted from the people's eyes and that the evil men and women in power be brought down, then you are suicidal. All right. Donald Trump said on Sunday that the gloves were going to be coming off this week. The gloves did come off this week. And you're going to see more of the gloves coming off. He says we're going to punch through the controlled media and that they need to collapse, that they're already insolvent. They are insolvent. And we are going to be writing articles about the different foreign media outlets, the different foreign combines from China to Saudi Arabia. To other organizations that are Mexico and their largest billionaire kingpin, who actually makes money off U.S. taxpayers with the Obama phone program. He owns that foreign contract. That's who owns the New York Times. So we're going to be exposing exactly the foreign interests that own our traitor media. And you have to understand, it doesn't matter if the New York Times loses 60, 70, 80 million a year. It doesn't matter if CNN's defraud. It doesn't matter if MSNBC's collapsed. They have to keep the facade up. And we're going to now advertise that those facades are foreign, owned, and run. Oh, yes. You just want to fight? You better believe you've got one. Because Donald Trump is willing to risk his life and go head up against you and expose the entire election fraud system that he exposed in 2012. And he's willing to expose the foreign banks and the communist Chinese infiltration and every bit of it. And that's why the whore media is up there saying he's a Russian agent. The Russians have their own interest, and they are involved in espionage in this country, and it's illegal. And it's thanks to Hillary again that they've gotten the uranium and some of the technology secrets, just like the communist Chinese, just like North Korea got its reactors to build bombs, atomic and hydrogen bombs, from Hillary and Bill and ABB in the mid-1990s. Always the same culprits, but they can point their finger and say, there's your foreign agent, the evil guy that builds buildings and golf courses and homes and companies and employs people. He's the bad one. He's the evil one. He's an economist. He's got an economics degree. He's not a lawyer. We need more lawyers. We need more communist Chinese spies. That's what we need. Not him. He's the problem. Bad Donald Trump. Bad. Shame on you. And they hope that a bunch of weak-minded idiots out there will not understand what's going on and will not be aware of what's unfolding. Now, I'm going to let you know about the specials we're running right now. We are running a special that's even bigger than last week. That was our biggest special in our history. Now, to be technical, we're only selling three things that are better deals than even last week. Vitamin Mineral Fusion, Brain Force, DNA Force, 40% off Brain Force, 30% off DNA Force. And Vitamin Mineral Fusion, which is an amazing fruit punch, totally natural, organic, where your body then can absorb all the nutrients and get the trace elements it needs. Simply amazing. Vitamin Mineral Fusion. And then on top of it, why is it a better deal? Because that was the same price it was last week, discounted. Free shipping on top of it. And if you sign up for AutoShip, an additional 10% off. That's 50% off Brain Force when you sign up for AutoShip. 40% when you don't. Now, continuing, we have a lot of other specials as well, but you always get 10% off when you sign up for AutoShip on any item. We also have specials going on some of the Patriot apparel. We have the Bill Clinton rape shirt. We have the Hillary for prison shirt. This is now reached a crescendo level of the desperate straits this country's in. But the fact that we can use this as an opportunity to really expose the power structure that's gone too far and finally turn this around. So store-wide free shipping, additional 10% off when you sign up for AutoShip, 40% off Brain Force, and so much more. But the really big deal is 30% off DNA Force. We rarely do that. And I intend to extend these sales through next week while supplies last. The problem is DNA Force is probably set to sell out in the next 3 or 4 days, so we'll probably have to pull that special, so take advantage of that. Go read the hundreds of studies, the patented ingredients like BioPQQ, and find out why it's such a game changer, and that similar formulas cost up to $400 to $500. Knockout, the ultimate sleep aid from our research, incredibly low price, $19.95. A bottle of melatonin of the same dose is usually $19.95. This has got the same dose in it and a whole bunch of other ingredients known to give you deep, restful sleep. When I forget to take it sometimes when I'm all hyped up, like lately I ran out at home. Right now I'm trouble sleeping. I never used to, but I mean, when stuff is this epic, when stuff's going on like this, I got to be honest with you, I'm bouncing off the walls without stimulants. I've been having like, you know, one coffee a day or whatever. And I was down here 7 days this last week. I just cannot stop working. And like I said, I'm going to be taking some time off from the radio just to codify the videos, the news reports, the special reports, the news articles, the research to prove the election fraud in 2012 and in the primaries this year, which is already proven. The primaries are open and shut. They went too far. And to really reach out to the Bernie people and everybody else, because nobody else is going to do it. I'm going to roll my sleeves up. I'm going to do it. Bet your bottom dollar. I'm going to do it. And so is Trump. And I guess the globalists say, am I looking for trouble? You bet I am. You people came looking for trouble. I'm sorry. You know, we're killing enough babies at the abortuaries and keeping them alive and selling their organs and heating hospitals with their dead bodies and splicing them with animals. And they got TVs watching everybody and they admit it on the news. And it's, you're a kook if you don't like it. And they're trying to break the family up and saying, get rid of the word mother and father. And, you know, we're done. Okay. I'm done. Whatever, however the chips fall, I'm done playing games. Obama has now warned Republicans. Oh, get me this new video. This just went up on DrudgeReport.com. We'll get it up on Infowars.com. Obama, Trump unfit, woefully unprepared for presidency, has to be a point where you say enough. They're getting ready to suspend the elections. They're getting ready to start race riots. They're getting, because they know he's a patriot. They've gone into full panic mode because they got his phones tapped and they know he's a patriot and willing to lose his life. This is unprecedented to have hundreds of top Republicans who have always been rhino, neocon globalists come out, from Brent Scowcroft right down to George Herbert Walker Bush, saying he's unfit. They're going to vote for Hillary, who the Bushes vacation with, who sold us out to the communist Chinese. It was the Bushes that sold us out to begin with to the communist Chinese. We have foreign interests that have sold us out and are literally shutting off our power plants. They shut off more than 3 of our power plants a week. China gets more than 3 a week. We are under economic warfare by globalists. We're going to get that video. We're going to play it. It's going up on Infowars.com right now. This is it. We finally got a candidate that's a patriot. We finally got somebody that beat the mainstream media, that beat the Republicans trying to suspend the election, trying to just install Paul Ryan, And now they're in the news acting like Trump's a kook, going, nobody tried to steal something from him in the primary. Nobody took anything from Bernie Sanders. And Bernie Sanders supporters are all over going, yeah, you did. Yeah, you did. See, Trump knows what he's doing. He'll get the Sanders people if they have any soul, any mind, any sense of not wanting to be robbed. They are going to realize that this is happening and that this is going on. But I want to thank the viewers, I want to thank the listeners for your financial support, buying things like water filtration systems so you don't get the glyphosate and the fluoride on the garbage, getting things like non-GMO, high-quality heirloom seeds, getting things like the books, the films, the videos to hand out to others, the T-shirts that spread the word about come and take it, and we're going to stand up so you meet like-minded people, and buy the nutraceuticals, because I just can't believe InfoWars is there with Drudge and Breitbart and the Daily Caller and a few others, and obviously the patriots of this country, of race, color, and creed, standing against the Pope and the Communist Chinese and the Saudi Arabians and the Mexican presidents and Mexican kingpins and all these people that are involved in all these horrible things, telling us we can't have Trump. And now the president holds a press conference of political correctness because he said, hey, why isn't that Muslim woman speaking? I don't like it in the Muslim culture that women aren't allowed to speak and got to wear hoods over their heads. Absolutely. We're sick of it. Trump can't go to Saudi Arabia and preach Christianity. This con guy's in the Muslim Brotherhood that Obama's all hooked up with that overthrew Egypt. That's what all of this has come down to. That's what we face as a society and as a culture. And remember, they said Drudge was a kook in the media. They said Drudge is crazy. He's making a big deal out of the fact that they canceled elections in Colorado and a bunch of other states and just handed it to Ted Cruz. I mean, that's completely normal. And look at this kook Trump. I mean, you know, he saw 8 million more people vote, and then he magically gets more less votes than McCain did in 2012. That's obviously fraud. And then they openly try to steal it from Trump, and he dares speak about it when they're rigging everything from Google to you name it. Now, let's go ahead and play this incredible Real Clear Politics. This is Obama addressing the press. And he says he's woefully unfit. 6-minute clip, here it is.
Thank you, Mr. President. Given the Republican nominee's recent comments about the Khan family and his statement that if president, he would consider recognizing Russia's annexation of Crimea, does it make you question his fitness to be president? And secondly, sir, on Libya, you've said in the past that the worst mistake of your presidency may have been your failure to plan for the aftermath of that 2011 NATO intervention in Libya. Do you see your new decision to bomb ISIS there as a direct result of that?
Yes. I think the Republican nominee is unfit to serve as president. I said so last week, and he keeps on proving it.
Hit pause. Back it up 10 seconds if you can. This is a guy who funded the Muslim Brotherhood and ISIS and Al-Qaeda to take down at least 4 countries. This is a guy who tells you that you're a bitter clinger if you're a Christian and own guns. This is a guy that has complete disdain for this country and has bankrupted it even more and broken every promise he made and foisted Obamacare on the people that took more than 35 million Americans out of full-time, higher-paid jobs into part-time, low-paid jobs because the corporations wrote it that way to drive down wages and create a giant glut of labor. This is a guy doubling black unemployment. This is a guy in Africa, basically installing leadership and funds where women have to sign agreements to be sterilized or to have abortions to get a tiny microloan. This is a guy literally out to kill black people. And I've got to hear all day how much he loves them. I mean, he is an abomination. And then he sits there and says, this man is unfit because he has top of his class economics degree and built a $50-plus billion company, and himself is worth over $10 billion. And You say he isn't fit when we don't even know what your real name is. And they found new brochures from the 1997 that you put out saying you were born in Kenya, which we all know was a scam to hide who your daddy really was. And we bought it for a while. Frank Marshall Davis. That's a scandal that you lived with the head of the Communist Party in Hawaii, who was a top pornographer. He wrote that in Dreams of My Real Father. That's a scandal enough. And then it's a spitting image. It's daddy. We got mommy posing naked on the couch that he's photographed on later. Open and shut. And you know why they put Obama in? Because he's totally blackmailed, folks, by all these foreign interests. And we are basically blackmailed by Saudi Arabia and Communist China. We are totally screwed over. We are in red level crisis. And you know the good news? The military, almost to a person, knows it. This little scam saying Trump doesn't like the military and made fun of this dead soldier or whatever, that's all made up. He said, why does Khan have his wife up there not talking with her part of her face covered up? That's what he said. Total distraction from Hillary helping kill hundreds of thousands of Christians in Syria, in Libya, in Egypt. That's the outrage. That's what's a big issue. Folks, I do not have words again to describe to you how historic all of this is, how over the top how all of this is, how amazing this all is. People keep saying, well, if Hillary's going to steal the election, what's the point of Trump saying it? Doesn't he want to encourage people to vote because landslides beat theft? He said that. He's going to fight it. He's going to point out she stole the nomination. Listen to me carefully, okay? The issue is she stole the nomination. She's a fraud. And that the Bernie people shouldn't just forget about that and we move on like goldfish with 10-second memory spans and attention spans, and that we have to make this the big issue and put out the reports and the videos, call them ads if you want, showing how they stole it, showing what they did, showing how Trump stood up and said no, so they had to back off. He's doing the right thing. He's coming out and speaking about this so that they understand he's not going to play games. And so it's a referendum on overthrowing the corrupt occupiers of this country, the foreign interest that run both political party machines, who are now showing the fact that the Republican Party is trying to keep him from fundraising and trying to give all of the votes they can, and having all the Republican leadership say they're going basically and voting for Hillary Clinton. This doesn't discredit Trump that our known occupiers, our enemies, the traitors, are putting everything they can against him. It's why we must have him. They're the ones running us in the ground. They're the ones bankrupting us. They're the ones starting the wars. They're the ones engaging in all this evil. They're the ones that want to make us poor to control us. They're the ones coming after our guns. They're the ones federalizing the churches with the faith-based initiative. They're the ones federalizing local schools. They're the ones federalizing local police. They're the ones funding the race war. They're the ones funding the division. They're the ones making you pay for people to have sex changes and pay for abortions. They're the ones. They're the ones. They're the globalists. They're the enemy. They're the problem. They're like the EU that came over and took over England. And we're saying, you know what, globalists? Get out of here. Where are you? And it's taken a just magic, beautiful Yankee like Donald Trump to stand up and say, you want to come after me? Go ahead. But I'm standing up for this country. We are forcing the globalists out in the open. We're making them tell big whopper lies. We're making them openly steal elections. We're making them come out and try to legitimize having superdelegates ignore giant landslides in primaries for Donald J. Trump. And as Trump said, it's hard to beat a landslide. And that's how we're going to try to stop this fraud. But if they do engage in fraud, we're going to catch them. And that's why Hillary's chief of staff calls it extremely dangerous, which is a threat. I hope the audience will come before God, even if you've not been a spiritual person or a Christian in your life. I pray that you will understand that there is such a thing as providence, and just focus on the fact. If you're a Christian, pray with me that a hedge of protection be put up around Donald J. Trump and all of us that are fighting for truth and justice, and that all of the enemy's plans be turned against him, and that we be given discernment and providence to overcome the enemy. But in the end, whatever God's will is, that is justice. And that we know in God's plan, this will all turn out to be for a very, very good reason. I just pray to God that we understand how incredible this period of history is right now. And that we thank God for Donald Trump, because Donald Trump is putting himself under the full media and psychic and cultural attack of the enemy. And it's real. It's not a put on. This is 100% real. The energy level is just rising to an absolute cacophony, a crescendo, a finale, a coup de grace, a Gutter-Dumerong battle. Oh, it's a twilight of the gods, all right, these would-be gods of the New World Order. They're no gods at all. Rock-Nuruk. And this is only the beginning. Know this. Trump's going to launch a TV network after this if they steal it. He's got sons that are even smarter than he is. This is only the beginning of the fight. Strike us down. Kill Donald Trump. Sons become 10 times more powerful. Kill Alex Jones. My message becomes 10 times more powerful. The enemy knows. They cannot win long term if we fight. We have the truth on our side. Now, let's go to Washington, where the enemy, this morning, just an hour ago, the full video is on InfoWars.com and DrudgeReport.com, Real Clear Politics from C-SPAN. The enemy, for 6 minutes, declared that you can't have Donald Trump, and he is afraid. They know he's landslide ahead. My numbers are at about 15 points ahead nationwide, ahead of Hillary. Oh, yeah, just like Bernie was. They're scared. Let's play the clip.
Yes, I think the Republican nominee is unfit to serve as president. I said so last week, and he keeps on proving it. The notion that he would attack a Gold Star family.
Hit pause.
That
they use this Gold Star like he attacked a family. He said, "What is this woman up here not talking?" Pointing that out. So they create these straw men. This is Obama that when cops get killed, he says they need to reform themselves so more get killed, saying it's their fault. This is the guy pushing the Trayvon Martin thing from the beginning to create division. This is a guy ripping off American taxpayers, shutting down our economy, screwing us over, outside of law, opening our borders up, inverting reality. And he just goes on babbling. I'm going to come back and play more of this. Then Matt Bracken's popping in. Then I'm going to open the phones up for your calls. And we've got a childhood college friend right through Bill Clinton and Hillary to describe what these monsters really are like. Second hour straight ahead. I'm Alex Jones. This is the defense of more than the Republic. It's a defense of humanity. We are not going in a fight against the New World Order. We're now in it, engaged in the biggest battle toe-to-toe with the New World Order Project since Cecil Rhodes launched it over 130 years ago. We are in the middle of a fight that defines the enemy. And that's why the longer we're in this fight, the stronger we get. Joel Skousen is a really smart guy, but he said, I'm afraid they're going to destroy Trump, set him up, steal the election, and then use that to discredit populism and nationalism, just as they're going to use shutting England down for Brexit as a way to punish everybody. Well, that will decide who we are. When the Germans bombed London, it made the British want to fight more. When the EU bombs them economically, it should make them understand what they're facing and understand that the parasite was going to suck them dry no matter what, so might as well stand up. It's the same thing here. Trump doesn't lose by losing. He enters the arena forever. Use a Greek analogy. He gets a constellation. That's the thing. It isn't about winning. It's about doing the right thing as an example to others. It's about defining things with the truth, not a bunch of damn lies. And they've sucked that out of the world. They've sucked manhood out of the world. People don't even know what they're looking at when they see it. Oh, look at that guy. He's getting ridiculed. He's a loser. Being ridiculed by an enemy press bought and paid for to distract you while the New World Order breaks down our society, poisons our culture, and reclimates you into the global system. I can tell you right now that the people understand what's going on. I can tell you right now that a large enough cadre worldwide understands what's happening, that it will grow into a force that is unstoppable by anything but God. Donald Trump is a rock star in Africa and in Latin America and in Asia and in Russia and in many areas of Europe, especially with young people. And I've already been saying this last year because I scan things, but I'm seeing it now in foreign press. People get it. The thinkers do. When the whole system that we know is screwing us and out to get us is telling us that somebody is the devil and misrepresenting what he says at every turn, this isn't something they're going to be able to put back in the cage. So I'm not giving you a pep talk here. I'm just saying I rarely disagree with Skousen, and I don't really disagree with him. I see the perspective. CJ, the same thing this morning. Oh, they're just going to spend this. I walked in and I said, oh, boy, that panics the New World Order. Got the White House run, folks, you know, saying 2 days after Alex Jones calls for Trump to talk about how only a landslide could block Hillary Clinton from stealing the election because she stole it from Bernie Sanders, word for word. I said, that's got to really get him upset. And he said, yeah, but we can always pop in if he wants to talk about it. He said, yeah, but they'll just use this to act like he's, you know, giving up. That's exactly what they're saying. You know, putting it in there that, oh, I'm a sore loser. No, he wasn't a sore loser in the primary. He was winning. They were stealing it. He pointed it out. And that's what he's doing right now. And yes, it's up to us. And CJ agreed. It is a referendum on us. Do we want to stand against the corrupt media that has a 6% trust rate? Do we want to stand against the whole corrupt Republican and Democratic establishment? Or do we want to just kind of act like we want to be betting on the winner? Or we care that they get a cacophony of people to just yell and scream in some weird popularity contest that Donald Trump's in trouble? It's all self-fulfilling prophecy garbage. I want to say something very important when we come back from break, but I'm going to preface it here. We're designed like humans that if we see a bunch of other humans drinking out of a river when we come to a town 1,000 years ago as traders, that you can drink out of that water. You know it's good. Everybody's drinking out of it. If nobody's drinking out of it, you go up and say, where's the well? Is the water not good? They use that instinct today against us where they have a bunch of fake astroturf say something so we feel like it's true. Just a few hours ago, President Obama had a special press conference to demonize Donald J. Trump and say he is unfit. The reason they're doing that is because, can you imagine the horror at White House-run Media Matters, George Soros-funded? Days after conspiracy theorists asked him to, Trump worries the election is going to be rigged. And he pointed out that Bernie Sanders had it stolen from him, but that Trump was having landslides so they couldn't steal the primaries from him and had to stand down. And that she better not try to steal the election. That is my advice. That is Stone's advice. But Trump is already on the same page. And they go into this article horrified that Trump must be doing what we tell him to do. Well, this isn't about a popularity contest. It is surreal to know that our common sense information is listened to by someone because he's not a traitor. But Trump already knows this. What we're saying is common sense. In 2012, when there were 8 million more voters than 4 years before, Mitt Romney was way more popular in polls than John McCain. He got less votes than the Republican did 4 years before. There was election fraud. And Donald Trump came out then and said this should be investigated. Donald Trump's very smart. But more importantly, he has the courage to come out and say, I'm not working with the Russians, but if Hillary deleted these emails illegally, I think the Russians should release them. By the way, the Wall Street Journal and others admitted her chief of staff got $35 million from the Russians in a weapons transfer. Her foundation got hundreds of millions of other dollars connected from Putin. She's the one selling out to everybody. She's the one that sold out the launch technology, the guidance systems, the boost phase, the reentry phase, the MIRV phase, the miniaturization, the entire system for deliverable ICBM payloads of up to 24 warheads or dummies over North America. Cruise missile submarine launch technology, on and on and on. Reactors to North Korea. So it's so sick to be informed and to sit there and watch them claim he's some type of Russian agent. But listen, he's 7 to 10 points ahead, and that's with closeted folks not saying they're voting for him. We think there's a 7 or 10 point lead on that as well. He could be 10, 15 points ahead of Hillary. That's why they're panicking. That's why they had Obama come out today and talk for 6 minutes about how Trump's unfit because he attacks Gold Star families. No, he saw that Muslim Brotherhood individual up there with his wife who didn't talk and said, why isn't she speaking? That isn't attacking their son. This is perfect straw man. And now it's Gold Star families. When almost the entire military supports Trump. It isn't to get the military to turn against him. It's to get Quislings to think that's happened and have a fake victory. But let's play a clip of Obama.
Yes, I think the Republican nominee is unfit to serve as president. I said so last week, and he keeps on proving it. The notion that he would attack a Gold Star family that had made such extraordinary sacrifices on behalf of our country. The fact that he doesn't appear to have basic knowledge around critical issues in Europe, in the Middle East, in Asia.
This is a guy that says we have 57 states.
Means that he's woefully unprepared.
That's good. To do this. Well, you've certainly been prepared to sell us out to the globalists. Trump's got good advisors. He knows Hillary is a communist Chinese spy, blackmailed by him. I mean, that's been a fact since the early 90s. But you've got all these top rhino Republicans coming out against Trump showing that this is the power structure against him. I want to play this clip where he talked about it being rigged and said they couldn't steal it from me because there were such landslides and I didn't go along with it. But Bernie did, and he's reaching out to the Bernie supporters, who are the vast majority of Democrat voters, to come over and vote for him. And it's hard to beat a landslide. We've interviewed all the experts. We've researched it in depth. Trump is really trying to win. And yes, Trump, if there's evidence of fraud, is going to fight it. Evidence she stole the nomination. And that's the argument I've made publicly in a public outreach to Trump. And I'm going to leave it at that. And you noticed, as the White House points out, less than 48 hours later, basically word for word, but not because I'm telling Trump what to say or do. It's the truth. It's what happened. I chronicled in the video what Trump said and then what transpired months ago. And I'm going to keep doing it. Paul Watts has got another article coming out in the next hour. We're going to just start chronicling how they stole the primaries, them bragging, the superdelegates admitting it, how they had a fake election in California. They went too far. We have them admitting the fraud. I'm going to say this again. We have them admitting they stole the election from Sanders. They were so arrogant, they had to get the other superdelegates to think it was normal, and the other delegates, so they had to do this gaslighting technique of psychology where they went, of course the delegates are sovereign and have always chosen. They never have. They changed the rule in 72, but never had the nerve to do it. There's election laws that block all that. It's all a fraud. We've talked to the experts. We've studied it. When I say talk to the experts, I'm an expert, folks. I live this. And so they had to act normal and go, oh, of course you don't count. That was also to get Bernie people to give up. But they didn't give up. Then they stole it in front of God and everybody else. And we're going to go pull up all the news articles and all the videos and say, you see what happened? And the White House, I know, is pulling their hair out. Matt Bragg's been with us for a full hour, 45 minutes, so we're about to go to him. And quite frankly, I don't get up here and brag about the power of this broadcast just to do it. I had a policy until about 3-4 years ago to kind of go under the radar and let the arrogance of the establishment just kind of keep them off my back. Because believe me, I've already dealt with a lot of dirty tricks and some other things that is unconventional warfare. Let's just say it's not been enjoyable, but it's part of what I'm doing. I've committed to this. It feel good in my gut and in my soul, but you know, my flesh sometimes is like, man, you really got to push this. And I'm like, you bet I'm pushing it all the way. I'm going all the way in their face. I'm not giving up. And you see the results. The fact that we have come from a group of one person 21 years ago to 60 people, and that's some of that's customer service and packing crew and you know, custodial. And we're talking maybe 25 people that I have in my operation, and we are devastating the globalists all over the world. I mean, having huge victories. It shows what you can do There are so many smarter men than I am, so many great people who don't see it as your role to fight back, who don't see it as your role to take action. It's no secret. Trump's going to gear up a TV network and take you all down, by the way. He's not giving up. This is just round one. He's got two sons ready and more. And I've got a son. I intend on producing more. This is a war. We're never giving up, never giving in. You understand that? And I'm only here to demonstrate the beta test. I'm only phase one, baby. The ones coming are a lot worse, globalist. This is a long fight. We're going to win it. Understand that. And everybody's morale needs to understand that. We're showing you what we can do, what you can do. This is only the beginning. We're never giving up. He's probably going to win the election, folks. He already played chicken with them repeatedly because he's willing to run his race car right into them. They're not. We're going to find out how far the New World Order wants to go. We're aware of false flags. We're aware of race riots. You going to go ahead and do this when the cops are almost all awake, the military are now? Let me just explain something to the New World Order and to the fear in Obama's eyes. You're scared for a good reason. Because you're finally up against people that know your whole game plan and aren't afraid. Matt Bracken, former Navy SEAL, best-selling author. His website is enemiesforeignanddomestic.com. And he's, again, got him here. We're going to break in about 3 minutes. I wanted to set the table here because a lot of stations join us in the second, third, and fourth hour about how epic a point we've reached. And I know we're going to get into all the Islamic invasion, accelerating. Merkel says he's going to expand that. Martial law declared in Germany, troops on the street to suppress the patriots, accelerating, bringing them in here. You know, larger long-term plan. We can see how they want to checkmate the patriots. It's with their Islamic proxy armies they're bringing in. I don't think for false flags now. That's to bring in more tyranny, phase one. But actually to put them in charge of us, as we're now seeing in Europe. So Matt Bracken, I mean, just give us about a 2-3 minute breakdown on what you think's happening right now. And am I wrong about how epic the situation is with Trump right now?
Not at all. This is epic for sure. This past week, I guess we had a little lull in the terror war, so we can focus on the media war. I call them, a lot of people call it the enemy media. They are a wholly owned parcel of the Democrat crime family, the crime machine, now the Clinton-Obama crime machine. I think at this point, Hillary could, you know, perform an abortion and eat the baby. And she would be excused. They would say, well, it was, you know, her own choice or the mother's choice.
Wait a minute. They have a weird meme they've put out where she eats babies and it's good. Were you aware of that?
No, but it nothing would surprise me. We really saw the enemy media go full Soviet in the last week. Full Soviet is my term for when we see these administration mouthpieces, whether it's Jay Johnson or Ash Carter. You know, look at the camera and say, you know, the sky is purple and up is down with a straight face. It's a Soviet, very Soviet in that. In the last week, we saw these memes pushed and literally within an hour go completely through the entire enemy media. One was dark. That was that the RNC convention was dark. That was in every headline the next morning. We all pointed out memes about that. The other one was Russians. It's the Russians that are the DNC hack. Is all a Russian, Trump is a traitor. Don't look at what is in the DNC wiki hacks. Look at the fact that it's the Russians. And apparently it's not the Russians. If the Russians were doing it, they would want Hillary elected to blackmail her because they'd own her with the top secret stuff they've got.
And it's Hillary, again, who has openly been caught at record levels selling uranium and weapons secrets to Putin.
And enriching her friends, you know, cutting her friends on these deals for millions of dollars. You know, you ensure the silence of your friends by paying them millions. The former DNC chairwoman, she's going to, you know, trundle off into the sunset with millions of dollars. The big one, though, this week for going full Soviet, I never saw anything like it, was this guy Khan, who's absolutely a Muslim Brotherhood. His function is what they call civilizational jihad. He's the jihadist with a tie, a jacket and a tie, who works for the Clinton law firm. You know, if you look at the Clinton law firm, the Clinton law firms also produce people like Lynch. You know, they're very long term in this civilizational jihad. Huma Ahmadine, she goes way back. All the law firms with Lynch, with this guy Khan, they're all part of the crime syndicate. You know, he went right up on stage, put up the picture of his son, and cried the crocodile tears. It was very well orchestrated. Unfortunately, Trump stepped in it. you know, he went right into the trap full steam. I don't think it'll matter after another like big attack like Nice or San Bernardino or Orlando. It'll just make Trump look smarter and Obama look like more of a traitor. I thought it was great today. Obama was definitely in panic mode, and him bringing up the names of like Ryan, McConnell and McCain, all that does is drive more people to Trump, because those are rhino sellouts. You know, they're pro-amnesty rhino sellouts.
Let me ask you this question. You know, a lot of people get confused. I'm against the militarization of police for no reason. I'm against asset forfeiture seizure without due process. I'm against some of the federal global policies in our police, but on average, the average cop's a pretty hardworking, dedicated person. They got a tough job. I don't like some of the revenue generation, but that's political. Just like Congress put in the TSA, but leaves our borders open. I don't hate the average TSA person. But clearly, the globalists and the Clinton crime family have been trying to get us with Obama to start a civil war with all this political angst against local government and against the average cop. With record numbers, you know, getting shot in the back, getting killed, and people celebrating it. It's so clear that the right moral move, but also the right strategic move, and I've done this the last 6-7 years, was to really understand that they want to discredit local government. That's what communists and terrorists always do in the phase where they're trying to fully take over. And I've reached out to the police and military like never before, and I'll tell you, the response has been unbelievable. And I'm not bragging. This happened. Our crew all saw it. I didn't want to get it on video to get them in trouble. The Secret Service, in their suits, but also in their gear, at checkpoints everywhere, were cheering us. They were talking under their breath, saying, we're under surveillance camera. I don't want to shake your hand, but we love you. The police, almost all of them were listeners, black, Hispanic, didn't matter. And that's happening all over the country, where I see police now, and they get tears in their eyes looking at me. And I talk to them, and they go, we know there's a takeover. We're scared. It's not that I'm that smart. They understand the intel that we've really got a globalist takeover. And then I guess that feels good to them that at least somebody knows. But, I mean, that's got to worry the New World Order, that the police and military are so awake, Matt.
Not only the police and military, but, you know, I have a 20-something daughter. They don't watch TV anymore. They consider television to be, you know, like an RCA radio. They watch the internet. And I forget where I heard this story, but I think you were on an airplane to Cleveland and Karl Rove was on the airplane, yes, too. And you were getting cheered and he was getting booed. I mean, you know, it's becoming more overt, but I think
by the time I got off the airplane walking to baggage with him, I'd probably ran into 20 people that, hey, I saw it on Twitter. I saw the video. In a 2-hour flight, by the time I get from Dallas where I confronted him to Cleveland, it was already everywhere. Again, how do they deal with that?
They can't. Well, unless they try to shut down the entire internet, that would be like my essay, Burning Down the House in 2016. If they can't succeed, if it looks like Trump is ahead in the polls, then they'll tear it all down. At the very pinnacle, at the very top, we're talking about people that can fly nonstop intercontinental, you know, and land at their retreat in Patagonia that's got, you know, 10 years worth of diesel for the generator. They think that's their backup plan. So no matter how bad it gets here, they'll, like, you know, they'll just skip to one of their remote castles.
Don't they know that people that lose families and things, I'm not making threats, but it's going to happen, will have 10-year projects to get there and find them? I mean, they're going, don't they know that no amount of security is ever going to protect them if they really do this?
Well, plus the security isn't going to stick around. Or the
securities. Well, most of securities are listeners.
Right. Yeah. So they're not going to, it's not going to be too happy for them. But that's what their plan. As I often say, a plan to ride a tiger is not the same as riding a tiger. It's just a plan. But their plan is, no matter how bad it gets, it'll be a cleansing. All of their cooked books will be burned in the fire. There won't be any evidence left. It'll all be like, who cares? What, at this point, what difference does it make? After the cities are burning, who cares? Their plan is sidestep to a private island, a mega yacht, Patagonia, and then come back when the
scapegoat the cops, let half of them get killed, bring in your new people later.
Well, that's their plan. I don't think it'll work. But
well, when I tell you that almost every single cop, state police officer, I don't care what color they were, and Secret Service agent was a intense listener, that has got to freak the. I mean, just.
But the chiefs are largely sold out politicians. You know, the chiefs are just eager to get more federal handouts and to turn over more of their local sovereignty.
And again, I'm not talking about me, Matt. I didn't used to do this. I'm in this position now where this is not enjoyable, this level of responsibility. I'm just saying when you're pinging at that level, and that's what, quite frankly, you know, I've talked to Trump about, and that's what he's seen, is that, I mean, I'd be in the arena, and there'd be like the head Secret Service people just smiling at me and waving at me. I'm just saying as a radar ping, the fact that I'm supposedly so radical, I'm really not, I'm just Americana, the fact that our message has penetrated everywhere has absolutely got to scare the hell out of the New World Order, because they're not going to run this operation with us flat-footed when their own people they're counting on to carry out the treason are so awake. And I've had police chiefs that they think are their buddies tell me privately, no, I'm not their buddies.
Yeah, and the boys and girls down in the fusion centers, they all have to be wondering what's going to happen if they do get orders, for example, to you know, to economically isolate enemies of the state. It would be very easy to do. You know, you can they can just trash somebody's credit cards, make it so that their what was it, the Will Smith movie,
Enemy of the State.
You know, nothing works. You know, you just the cash in your wallet is all you've got. They can do that pretty easily, but. You know, will the boys and girls down in the fusion centers obey, you know, Gestapo-like orders? That's the question. And I don't know, because the last 8 years, they've only been hiring social justice warriors. That's how we wind up with a sold-out FBI.
We just lost Matt Bracken. We're going to get him back. Skype went out for a moment. And again, folks, when I keep talking about InfoWars here, I've been very humble over the years. This is not something I even want to get into. My dad called me this morning, and he said, so how is it now to be so dangerously in the zeitgeist? And, I mean, let me tell you, I'm experiencing stuff that almost nobody ever gets to experience. I mean, and believe me, be glad you're not. This is history. And you're sitting here with just Donald Trump, Matt Drudge, and a few other people. And you never expected yourself to be in this position. It's quite a fraternity, let me tell you. And you know you're being listened to by the good people, but also the bad guys. And, you know you have influence with your common sense and your analysis. And we've got the archive of knowledge, so we're able to get data packages to people that lay it out as briefings. I mean, I'll sit around and prepare a briefing for somebody, you know, for a whole day if I need to. That's what I do. And then I brief people, and then they go check it out for themselves, and then it has an effect. Can you imagine being Obama and the globalist? I mean, talk about a nightmare scenario. A nightmare scenario. I mean, they have constant meetings in Congress about Drudge, how they want to shut him down because they can't control a narrative, because they'll have Obama say, I never said you could keep your doctor, and then Drudge just puts a link up where he says it. That's not magic. I'm not magic. Trump's not magic. If Trump wins by 70-something percent, he gets the delegates, not somebody else. It's not magic. We're saying 2 plus 2 equals 4. They're not. Again, I agree with you, Matt. I think Obama, watching his body language, looks completely freaked out. I think because of the closeted voters, I think Trump's probably 15 points ahead. I think they know there's a Trump landslide coming.
Yeah, the polls are completely bogus. They're just propaganda push polls. You know, you see a poll by a network that is a quizzling network that immediately picks up all the, you know, the Soviet-style memes, dark RNC convention, Russians did the DNC hack in concert with Trump. Khan is the most wonderful gold star dad in the world, and Trump's an evil monster. They've gone full Soviet. The polls, you can't believe at all. Nobody under the age of 30 has a landline phone. How do they conduct these polls? Garbage
They're calling
in, garbage
Alzheimer's
out.
Patients. They've got a database of them. They admit it.
Right. It's garbage in, garbage out. The polls are nothing more but than propaganda.
Stay there, Matt Bracken. Make no mistake, ladies and gentlemen, you are watching history unfold now. You are in the middle of 1776 Part 2, and you will determine the outcome. Get on your knees and pray to God. What do you make of Donald Trump coming out and saying we need a landslide to defeat Hillary because only landslides defeat attempts to steal elections, which is true. And they stole the primaries from Bernie. They tried it with me, which is all admitted fact. The mainstream media is saying this is crazy. Nobody stole anything from Bernie. There were never superdelegates claiming that Trump could be blocked. It was all over every TV channel for months. It's all completely admitted. But they just say it never happened. I've got thousands of articles. I mean, I was there this morning looking at it where I would type in Donald Trump election rigged, and it would say like 18,000 articles. In fact, let's do it on Google right now for TV viewers. I'll show people. And just click news, type in Donald Trump may rig election. Now, they're spinning it that he said they will rig it, so just give up. No, that's not what he said. And then he's afraid he's going to lose, so they're doing this. No, he knows in their own internal polling with real polling companies, they want real numbers because they want to know where they're going, that he's 7 to 10 to 12 to 14 points ahead. And when they scoop folks randomly off the street and do focus groups all over battleground states, minorities, you name it, most of them are actually for Trump. They know this. Okay, Trump knows. And I'm gonna stop right there and leave it at that, okay? But I don't need to believe folks that have done focus groups and polls. I'm out there in the street. I'm not up in some ivory tower at Martha's Vineyard drinking red wine and talking about how wonderful the world will be once it's depopulated. I'm actually researching what's going on. I tell you, it is a creepy, 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 creepy feeling. You know, it's not like you're in college and you're writing your thesis paper or something. People get, you know, get nervous about that. Or you're in high school and finals and you're nervous about that. Imagine writing articles, putting out stories and reports, and then they're the number one thing in the world. And people listen. And foreign leaders listen. It's come out over and over again. And I sit here, it's so surreal. And it's not about Alex Jones or InfoWars. It's about what are we saying that's so powerful? It's real analysis. It's classical Americana. It's interviewing thousands and thousands of experts in every field to get a clear picture of not what the Soviet media is telling us, but what's really happening in the world. And what's really happening is we have a global elite that controls the currency of the world that is bringing in a planetary tyrannical regime and abolishing borders to abolish the people's right to resist it. And this system creates poverty to financially control you, and they've codified it into Agenda 21 and into Agenda 2030, which are official UN ratified treaties, not by us, but ratified globally, and we're under it. And you go read what they said they're going to do, they're doing all of it. Obama goes to Africa and says you can't have air conditioning in your car. That's what they mean. Folks, this is scientific evil developed by Prince Philip. And you better get a crash course in it. It claims it's liberal and loving and anti-racist because it is racist. When they got the documents 6 years ago from the Copenhagen UN Treaty, it turned out that it basically doubled taxes on the third world, and many analysts said it would kill a billion people in 10 years. They've started the global culling. They've started the deindustrialization. They've started the shutdown. This is 21st century war. Our species isn't getting attacked by some outside aliens. It's being attacked by technocrats, elites, that have set up a scientific plan to order the world and take it over and control it and end free will. I'm going back to Matt Bracken here in a moment. Your phone calls at 800-259-9231. But just look at the economic numbers. They're racing towards a global collapse. Many big European banks have lost half their value. CNN, the humbling of the American tech giants in China. Oh, we were supposed to always be the tech leaders. We were sold out. We were supposed to be service. That's being sold out. It's a plan to set us up and then dictate the terms of our surrender. That's Bloomberg. Global stocks drop. Yen strengthens as growth worries resurface. Japan, $276 billion stimulus plan, much smaller than it looks. This is just some of the news today. If I was a selfish person, I would be headed to the most rural area right now with my family, and I'd just disappear right now. I'm telling you, folks, the world you've known is about to be gone. Get ready. I don't know how the breaks are going to go, but let me tell you, the New World Order is even scared. When you look at them on TV, this is out of control, like Bracken keeps saying. It's one thing to set up this plan for world government and have all your computers and your actuaries and your algorithms. It's another thing to actually get on the horse. And let me tell you, we're all on the horse. I'm going to briefly say this and I'm done. We're funded by you, not by big fat cat sponsors, not by stimulus money, not by taxpayer money like MSNBC and NPR and all the rest of them. We sell great nutraceuticals, great storable foods, great water filtration systems, great solar panel and control unit systems that are really the best units out there for the lowest price. We've got everything. from Vitamin Mineral Fusion to you name it. Brain Force is a great natural nootropic. Some of these ingredients are prescription in Europe. It's 40% off right now, $17.76, and there's free shipping. So we had to get rid of a lot of the specials, but the three or four we kept, we're giving you free shipping on top of it. Vitamin Mineral Fusion. We've also got specials on DNA Force. And the funds you send to us, well, you see what we do. We change the world. We go in when nobody else will. And we give a platform to all the other great patriots that want to fight in the information war and want to get everybody ready and geared up. Infowarsstore.com, InfowarsLife.com, go right to the nutraceuticals, or call toll-free, 888-253-3139. And I want to be very clear. This isn't rhetoric. Both my grandfathers were in the Army Air Corps. One was a fighter pilot, one was a B-17 pilot. And when they would say in the ads and newspapers and newsreels that men and women back at the factories making those planes and making those bombs, and the people that delivered those bombs, the people that sat on those airfields and loaded those bombs, were just as important as the people that flew in there and dropped those bombs. And you better believe this is a 21st century high-tech war. And all of you funding us allow us to stand up against the enemy and their dirty tricks, everything else they do, and to be strong in the face of this and to really be able to go to the next level. And you have my commitment, whether we're able to go on 6 months or 10 years, I will continue to go on to the end, whatever happens. But I need, metaphysically, the fuel to fuel the planes, and I need all of you to buy the products and to pray for us and to spread the word, 360 win, to fight these people. And we need you to get the material and the articles of all these other great people that are already prominent, but many of which we're trying to elevate, so that there's more people and, quite frankly, a bigger officer class in this organic resistance to the New World Order if they wipe out people like Donald Trump or Matt Drudge or myself or others. Because it's a really weird feeling not be worried about yourself, but being guilty if they kill you that you can't keep fighting. And we're here, folks. This is real. This is history. They don't want you to be real. They don't want you to believe there's hope. There is. Matt Bracken, I want to take calls, but I want to give you the floor about the latest Islamic attacks, the changing the name from Ali to David, not saying it's Islamic when they cut the priest's head off, massive censorship intensifying. I mean, this is really, really crazy. And then putting the Islamists in the positions of power to rule over us. I mean, it's really happening.
Hope. Even the Pope.
Yes.
Pope Francis, you have to remember, Pope Benedict did not die in office. He was not ruled incompetent or something like that. It was a coup. It was a coup of the social justice warrior Marxist priest class that took him, that took Benedict out and put a lackey in, a Marxist lackey. That's the guy that just said that
there is no Islamic terror, and it's blasphemy to say it. We must open our borders. It's so unthinkable. It was the Associated Press. I can't even believe he said it. Go ahead. Sorry.
And how can anybody look at something like that and not see it as, one more clanging bell alarm?
Does this not signify they're going for broke, as you said? This signifies
going for broke. Even to take out the Pope and put in a Marxist, a Marxist stooge at best, and a willing participant at worst. And I want to say something about the media. I got to go back to the Soviet enemy media. I can't. It blows my mind even more than say this full court press, but with Khan, who got, 50 times more coverage than the Benghazi families in 3 days than they got in since Benghazi.
Yeah, they've been dehumanized.
But the WikiLeaks, which they turned into a Russia and Trump attack perfectly, the WikiLeaks shows that Politico, the Washington Post, name brand big shots like Chuck Todd and Jake Tapper, they're taking their instructions from the DNC. It's like going back to George Stephanopoulos in the Romney first debate when he brought up birth control. That was a talking point that he was assigned. He's a DNC agent. He used to run the Clinton war room in the first Clinton administration.
And they've got their people everywhere.
Right. Wolf Blitzer dancing and drinking champagne. Whoops. Am I on camera? So the fact that these guys like Chuck Todd and Jake Tapper can still go on television and not have people out on the street when they have those, glass wall studios, throwing paint at the window or something, it's a joke. This is like the Soviet Union. Jake Tapper, Chuck Todd, Wolf Blitzer, Washington Post, Politico, These guys are named. They're cooperating. The emails show, well, do you want us to scratch any of those questions out? Or you can get pre-approval, but if these questions aren't suitable, just give us the questions you want. Come on, America. This is a joke. The FBI is sold out. The Pope is a stooge, a Marxist stooge. The media is completely on board with it, with this. What is it going to take to wake this country up? A super 9/11? Of course, if that happens, that'll be used as an excuse to abolish the internet or take it down for a while and tame it. But everybody needs to know this can turn very quickly. This is like the moment where the cold water turns to ice in a hurry. You know, you went to bed, it was water. You wake up, it's ice. Every morning when I turn on the TV, I'm wondering, when is it going to be the day that we see an aircraft carrier on fire in the Persian Gulf? You know, something on that level. A bank crisis in Germany and runs on banks. Something huge is going to happen. We can all feel it. We don't know what it's going to be, but we all feel it. We can all tell. This is like May of 1914 in Europe with trains going in all directions full of troops and artillery. We don't know where it's going to happen, but it's about to happen. It's definitely about to happen.
It's about to happen, and I can just feel the energy level. I can see it, and I see Donald Trump, who I was holding my nose about supporting a year and a half ago because they were attacking him. He was a nationalist. He had, you know, some liberal background I didn't like. But I tell you, getting to really know the real Donald Trump and seeing what's happened, he's got a lot of courage. He's under the biggest...
At least he's a fighter. At least he's a fighter. Sometimes you just need a scrapper. You know, we don't have any more use for these Marquis de Queensberry, ballet dancer pugilist.
Well, I was about to say, but he knows the stakes, and he's
obviously... We need street fighters. We need a street fighter now. We've had enough of these Marquis de Queensberry sissies that prance around the ring, but as soon as somebody touches their jaw, you know, they go flying over the they go flying out of the ring. I mean, we need a fighter. Now, he's unkempt, he's uncouth. You know, he says a lot of the wrong things. They laid a brown paper bag full of poop in front of his door, and they lit it on fire.
Doesn't matter, though. He's got guts, and guts is enough, and he's our champion, and we're going with him.
And the thing that's got the globalists in mortal panic is that a year from now, if there's a attorney general, Andrew McCarthy, Giuliani, these kind of people, Democrats are going to prison for treason and for espionage. Prison. Hard prison. You know, the statute of limitations on what Hillary did with the server is 7 years.
What do you expect? Let me bring this up. If Hillary gets in, what do you expect?
I expect that they're going to try very hard to crack down on the internet and on free speech. She's already a strong supporter of this UN Resolution 1618, which basically institutes global blasphemy laws. That would be ahead of our Constitution.
And the mainstream media is getting its butt handed to it by the new media. And so they're going to be more than happy to go along with this. We already see the censorship intensifying.
They have to. And we're very lucky that we have Europe to look at. So we can look at Europe where they have no First Amendment. And they're arresting Germans that are protesting about their own invasion. I mean, imagine it's, you know, your country's being invaded in a hostile, you know, with the Quislings opening the gate for the jihadists, and the people that are complaining about it get arrested. So we're very fortunate that we have a worst case scenario unfolding in Europe right before our eyes.
I tell
you, we're not unarmed and we have a First Amendment.
Let's go to phone calls. Matt Bracken's our guest. We're going to go to John, George, Kevin, Mark, and many others. Let's go ahead and go to George in Connecticut. You're on the air with Matt Bracken.
Hi, guys. I just came up with two issues that I'd like you guys to comment on. We know that he I was watching CNN and watching the whole thing on the TPP thing that Obama was talking about. That's the one issue. But the second issue, I'll get in later. He was saying that he's unfit for office, but he didn't seem to – he went down a list of why he was for the TPP, and he was going down a list, and the one thing he mentioned that he had to have trafficking in the particular TPP. Trafficking is slavery. So he's saying that Trump is unfit, but he's saying slavery is good. Is that unfit?
Well, how about having foreign multinational secret groups running our country's decisions? That's unfit. Absolutely. Matt?
Well, it's almost beyond belief, but right now the Department of Homeland Security is being run by the Muslim Brotherhood. Obama put in these CARE and other groups to be to run interference against the FBI for the jihadists. So nothing would surprise me that the first Clinton regime, they through Loral for money, they gave the intercontinental ballistic missile technology to China on a platter. They invited the Chinese scientists into Los Alamos and everywhere else. They even took away the colored badges that they could tell like who's foreign, who's American, who has a clearance, because it was bad.
And then they have our news and movies announce we got our rocket technology from China. They invert everything.
Right. And so there's massive treason that's gone on. Now, in a Democrat welfare state, maybe it won't matter. Like I said, Hillary could, eat a baby on television and it wouldn't matter, because the people who are welfare slaves, the welfare slaves on the EBT plantation, all they care about is that every 2 weeks their EBT card gets recharged with cash, with electronic cash. And otherwise, they really don't care. This is why they're bringing in all the illegal aliens. They're even flying them in from Guatemala and Honduras because it's too dangerous for them to make the trip. We'll send an airplane, and then your parents can come next year.
Well, and the Supreme Court rules it's illegal, but they just go ahead and go forward with it.
They don't care.
George, what was the other question?
The other question, question, I just want you to realize that he's been selling visas and the citizenship to foreigners, Muslim foreigners in particular, because he's also a lawyer for Sharia law. So he wants to bring in Muslims. He's selling them. I forgot the name of the visa.
No, I'm aware of it. Thank you. We're going to talk about when we come back, George. Thank you. Then Charles, John, Kevin, Mark, and others. We're back live. Matt Bracken's our guest. 5 minutes to the next hour. We have another guest popping in to talk about her history with the Clintons.
Hide behind discs.
The whole Republican establishment is against Trump, which just shows how criminal all of this has really gotten. And the whole stage is set for any type of tyranny you can imagine with a media that will just lie about anything. I'm really surprised at how corrupt the average person is. That last caller, George, he had one other question. You want to respond to what he was saying, Matt Bracken?
We're talking, it was the TTP, or no, he was on Dick Khan and the Muslim Brotherhood.
Yes, about Obama selling visas.
Yeah, that's called civilizational jihad. People need to read this book. It's not a thick book. It's only a couple hundred pages, if that. See Something, Say Nothing by Phil Haney. If you don't have time for books, go on YouTube and just look at the Senate hearing testimony in the middle of June. The country has been sold out. Traitors have taken over, basically. And the most shameful thing and sad for me is to watch the FBI take a dive on this, like FDR ordering the FBI to not talk about Germans in the 1930s. And the FBI saying, fine, no more German investigations. It's just very disheartening.
It's incredible.
Media, you expect the media to be prostitutes, prestitutes. You don't expect much from the media. They just are attention whores with $1 million salaries.
I think it's just become the cowardice, because people don't realize what comes next, the total tyranny. John in Wyoming, you're on the air. Go ahead. Thanks for calling.
Yeah, Alex, you've got a great guest again, as usual. Way to go, Matt. You're right on a couple of issues. Number one, on these phony pollsters, remember in 1984, these same crooked pollsters said that Mondale and Ferraro were going to steamroll over Reagan and Bush. Yet when the voting had been done, Reagan and Bush picked up 525 Electoral College votes, while Mondale and Ferraro picked up 13. It was the biggest drubbing since FDR defeated Alf Landon in 1936. Also, I heard on mainstream media yesterday that one of the major banks in Italy is being bailed out to the tune of 5 billion euros. So the collapse is not too far down the road.
Yes, that's true. But the problem is they've now put in their special black box systems, Mr. Bracken.
Yeah, I think that unless it's a landslide, like a 1980 landslide, my first presidential vote cast was for Ronald Reagan. And like the caller said, we didn't know, because it was neck and neck. We didn't know, and then it turned out to be a blowout. I know that a lot of, I don't see bumper stickers at all, none for Hillary, of course, but I don't see them for Trump either. I think people are afraid of getting their car vandalized. That's the state of this country now. But it could be a blowout. But unless it's a blowout, they'll cheat and win. But I don't think that they'll allow even a blowout to go forward. For example, if their secret internal polling shows a solid Trump lead going into the elections, I think they'll do some, you know, other form of a destabilization op just to prevent the elections. Something like, you know, a campaign of snipers.
That's right. I mean, they've got Obama on TV saying you cannot have Trump. They right. look scared. I mean, they're going to pull in. I think Trump's 10, 15 points ahead.
Yeah, and I think that no matter what, they are not going to let him be inaugurated and then let, you know, Attorney General Giuliani put them in prison for espionage and treason.
Well, the larger issue is we're fighting back, so we're exposing their program. We're not just going along quietly now. And so their arrogance has been handed to them over and over again. Look at the superdelegates with Trump. So it's an exciting time to be alive. John, thank you so much. Great points. All right, Kevin and others, your calls are just 70 seconds away as we start the third hour. I'm Alex Jones. Paul Watson joins us in the fourth hour. 10 years ago, almost no one knew the Federal Reserve was private. People weren't talking about world government. Now it's all mainstream news. The Pope has to say it's a good thing. We've only begun to fight. So we're talking about some scary things here, but this is not negative. It's positive to know the truth. It's positive to understand what's happening and to know that this is the animating contest that will test our mettle. Right now, let's go to Kevin in Florida. Kevin, you're on the air with Matt Bracken and Alex Jones. Go ahead.
Thank you so much, Alex, fellow conspiracy theorist here. I just had a quick point that I'll get to my question. I wanted to ask Matt what he thought about the government's successful plan to get everybody to identify with their race, and everybody to get to identify with the current groups. If you're black, you have to be a Democrat and think the man's against you and everybody's racist. If you're white, you got to cower in the corner in fear and think that your white privilege got you everything. And this leads us to, if the globalists are successful in stealing this election, which many people think, do you think there's going to be this big civil unrest for like-minded individuals like myself and fellow InfoWarriors that aren't going to stand idly by and let this happen?
Nation plan, this racializing the politics in this country. I was in the military, and everybody in the military, you kind of get an attitude that we're green. You know, we're all green. If people that were never in the military never saw a really desegregated society like the military is at its best, if the power goes out and there's massive looting, then I think that it's going to be very hard to not have a racial aspect to the civil breakdown, unfortunately. I think that we do need to stand on the Constitution. You know, the Constitution is what unites us. We don't take an oath to the leader or the patria. We take an oath to the Constitution. And the Constitution is not a racial document. Anybody that's a race hustler, anybody that's, you know, spreading racial dissension should really be seen as un-American.
And let's be clear. The globalists have it in the cards to use a civil breakdown, a societal collapse, to bring in control. And so clearly Absolutely. That's why they've invoked all this race, so we don't organize together against the globalists during a collapse, which shows us they're really thinking about going to this next level.
Yeah, there's a fabulous book out. The author's name is Larson, and it's In the Garden of Beasts. And it's about the Nazification of Germany during the 30s. It's written by from the letters of ambassador who was sent over there and his daughter, watching the internal Berlin political machinations. And it's really amazing to see a lot of the parallels, the media being co-opted, you know, the enemies of the state being, you know, kicked out of their jobs, the Jews, et cetera.
Oh, it's a definite totalitarian takeover.
But there's the thing. Every takeover before, all the average people had to go on was the mainstream media. You know, the big newspapers basically could get us in and out of wars just by cooperating with the powers, you know, the powers that be in the White House. The Spanish-American War, they said, you provide the what is it? I'll provide the war. You know, you provide the headline.
You provide the paintings, the illustrations. I'll supply the war. That was William Randolph Hearst.
Right. And the difference is, and this is the real fly in the globalist ointment, we have our own weapons now right here. We're very powerful. Social media is power. And now, of course, 80% of the people, unfortunately, might be watching the Kardashians, and they wake up wondering who the Bachelorette is going to choose. And for those people, there's almost no hope. They're just going to be shocked and amazed when the TV goes black and the water tap is dry. They're not going to know what hit them. But for everybody else, at least we can prepare. You know, we know that where the train is going out of control down the tracks.
Exactly.
And the bridge is
Matt
out.
Bracken, always great having you on. EnemiesForeignAndDomestic.com. We're going to come back with another guest, more calls, and a ton of news. Paul Watson coming up as well. Thank you, Matt Bracken. Yeah. Bottom line, use the internet while we've still got it. These information warfare weapons are important. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us. I'm going to continue with your phone calls in this hour. With us for the next 30 minutes is Dolly Kyle. Heard a lot about her over the years. Childhood friend of Bill Clinton, and then knew them right through until they became, big, high-powered folks in politics. She graduated from SMU School of Law in Dallas. She practiced real estate law in Texas and founded Lawyers for Affordable Housing that provided pro bono legal service for low-income homeowners and for nonprofit housing groups like Habitat for Humanity. She met former President Clinton on a Hot Springs golf course later when she was 11 and was almost 13. Their friendship grew through high school and college and became a decades-long affair that lasted despite marriages and politics all the way to the threshold of the White House when she became a political liability. And he threatened to destroy her, as Hillary had done to so many of his other women over the years. Hillary, the other woman, pulls no punches in describing the way media magic makes Clinton stories disappear. And the new book is from WNDBooks.com and Amazon.com. You can find it. Hillary, the Other Woman, a Political Memoir. What a lot of courage, to say the least, she has to go public. There are a lot of other women with documentation going public. People have been killed. They've been tortured. They've had their homes taken by these monsters. And to see them claim that they represent women in this gimmick that, you know, let's play the female card. I would vote for a woman for president in 1 second if they were a patriot. In fact, I think this is just like Obama, the supposed first black president, and doing all these horrible things was very discrediting and was done on purpose. They created a great division when they promised unity. Salt was placed in the wound and then ground in with great fervor. Same thing's going to happen with the so-called glass ceiling. But Dolly Kyle is our guest, and we're going right back to your calls and all the other big news. What's exciting is that Trump knows they tried to steal the primary from him, and he fought back, and they had to back off. He's doing the same thing with Hillary, and the media is freaking out, but he promises to, quote, punch through the media. We're going to be getting to that coming up as well. But Dolly Kyle, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, you're welcome. I'm happy to be here, finally, after we've sort of played phone tag for a couple of weeks.
It's really good to have you here. Well, let's go back. Why you've decided to go public, what it's been like, the threats. People need to read this book. People need to know who the real William Jefferson Clinton is, who the real Hillary Rodham Clinton are, obviously.
Well, you made it sound so good, I want to reread it. thank you for the nice introduction. Why now? I did not want to write this book, Alex. I'm a novelist, and I wrote a lot of this story about Billy and Hillary and our relationship in loosely autobiographical fiction, and that's really what I wanted to do. But I will tell you what tipped it. Last December, I was watching a pre-recorded television show, skimming through the commercials, and I saw Hillary, so I backed up and listened to it, and I saw the now famous clip where she said something like, women who say they've been raped and sexually assaulted should be believed. We deserve to believe them. And it went all over me. I mean, it just went all over me, because this hypocritical liar is looking in the camera with as much sincerity as she can muster, and trying to pretend that she's supporting women when she has been attacking Billy's friends, girlfriends, rapees, assault victims since 1974 that I know of. And it just made me sick. So the next day, I sat down and started writing the book.
And now it's not a novel, as a lot of folks put reality into novels to protect the innocent themselves. Now it is nonfiction. Hillary, the Other Woman. a political memoir. Obviously, folks need to read the book, but give us the key points of who Bill Clinton really is and who Hillary really is.
In a nutshell, these are two very sick, untreated, addicted people. Hillary is addicted to power and money, and then more money so she can get more power. Billy is clearly addicted to sex. And I talk about this in the book, but obviously we can't cover 292 pages in 20 minutes. So there is that. And then at the end of the book, well, you mentioned media magic, but chapter 47 is media magic, how to make a story disappear. And it tells from my own personal perspective back in the 90s when I ended up filing a lawsuit against Billy Clinton, who was the sitting president at the time, and probably no one ever heard of that because NBC, for example, didn't think it was news that someone was suing the president of the United States, nor that the issue of whether he could be sued in office when it went to the United States Supreme Court and I won was even newsworthy then. So this is the way it happened, and it's very hard for people who have lived, let's call it normal lives, to believe what is going on behind the scenes. I'm not sure I would believe it if I just heard it from someone.
Obviously, I'm going to read the book myself, but give us a gestalt when you talk about her power hungriness, his, I mean, reportedly he wants like 10 women a day.
Well, I don't know. I guess it depends on what day it is and what he did the day before. I'm not sure. But the bottom line is that these people will stop at nothing to get back into the White House. And that when they were in there, you know, one of the first things that Hillary did was to have Craig Livingstone, who was the security director in the White House, and by the way, his background for that was as a bar bouncer, and he couldn't even get security clearance, but what he could do was grab 900 FBI files, and the media sort of poo-pooed that and called it FileGate, and I don't think people have thought through how critically important that is, because when it came time for Billy's impeachment, there weren't just 900 people in Washington terrified that the Clintons had their files. There were thousands, because they didn't post the list and say, okay, we have Senator so-and-so and Representative such-and-such and Judge whoever. No one knew how many they had, and so everyone was afraid to talk. This is why I put my dirty laundry in the book. There's nothing they can blackmail me with. The book is not salacious. It's not full of sex details or anything like that, because that's not relevant to this story. However, since I am getting a little bit tired of people calling me a liar, I will say people can go online if they're interested, and they can Google Dolly Kyle, Jones versus Clinton lawsuit deposition. You can see Billy's own lawyer asking me under oath, confirming that I had a decades-long relationship with Billy Clinton that was consensual. And Billy denied anything about me under oath, except he tried to be nice to me in high school. But there are also handwritten letters from Billy to me that are appended to that deposition. So there, I hope that takes
care
of that.
Well, sure. I mean, we know they always attack the women, but it's, I mean, Bill Clinton's well-known with his exploits, settling at least one rape lawsuit. What do you think? Hillary. What do you know about Hillary?
On rape. Juanita Broderick did not sue him and did not file criminal charges. If she had filed criminal charges, she could have filed a criminal charge against Hillary as an accessory after the fact, because Hillary threatened her to keep her mouth shut after Billy raped her in 1978 when he was attorney general and running for governor.
Sure, sure. Long time.
Very important, Alex. In chapter 50, I talk about the 17 truth suppression techniques that the Clintons use, and I did borrow these with permission from Dave Martin, DC Dave. And the other thing is that I believe a serious problem, politics aside, is the fact that Hillary is showing signs of increasing cognitive impairment. And after one radio show, someone I knew sent me an email and said, what's cognitive impairment? And so for those who don't know, it's kind of like when you're losing it, you know.
She acts like a homeless person on the side of the road a lot of the time.
Yeah, and in chapter 50, I go through some of the symptoms of cognitive impairment that are listed on the Center for Disease Control's website. Anyone can go there and look, and then look at her behaviors. One of the things is loss of memory. Now, this puts Hillary in an interesting position. Is she losing her memory because of this cognitive impairment? Or did she say under oath 250 times, I don't remember because she was lying. So we have a choice. She can flip a coin. She was either lying or she's cognitively impaired.
Well, I mean, we know she's a bad actress. All that weird stuff at the DNC looked like John Wayne Gacy or something hopping around the stage, spatting at balloons. Doesn't Bill look bad? I mean, just talking about how he looks, all shaking. He looks like an Undertaker or something from a horror movie.
Yeah, and speaking of Undertakers, this is sad to say, but when you're approaching 70, as we are, a lot of times you just see your friends at funerals, and I've seen him two or three times in the last year at funerals of mutual friends, and each time, the guy in the casket has looked better than Billy.
What's the word on him? Parkinson's? What's going on?
Yeah, well, I don't know. I've heard the same things you've heard. I've observed the same things you've observed, but I have no inside information on that.
Sure. Talking about Hillary, though, and her, I mean, look, we'll get to Hillary in a minute and her power trip, but sexually, I mean, these women have all basically said the same things before it was ever on the news about Bill isn't just crooked in one way, and his penchant to beat women up, to bite them and stuff. Did he ever do any of that to you?
Our relationship was purely consensual, and you'll remember, I met him when I was 11. He was 12, going on 13.
You were friends.
We were friends. We dated in high school. We had what I would call a very normal relationship for a while. But he never, it was never harassment. It was never assault. It was always consensual. But I will say this, I did not know about his rape and sexual assault.
So would you say he's a pretty nice guy then? I mean,
yeah. I mean, and everyone we went to high school with, I mean, I think everyone generally liked Billy. He did lose the election for senior class secretary to his next door neighbor, Carolyn Yeldon.
Sure. From everybody I've talked to, though, and of course this has been documented, but would you concur that Hillary pretty much wears the pants and was kind of his enabler and would cover up from him and was kind of his beard for his sexual exploits?
That's a little bit more exaggerated than I would say it and more general, but I can't really argue with that. I'll go with that.
So she wasn't just co-president then. Was she like 60-40? Or, I mean, how would you estimate that?
I would not estimate that. I think a lot of times Billy humored her by letting her do things, and it was always things he didn't want to do. The one thing about Hillary is that she is a very hard worker, and she's a fighter. And, you know, that's, I guess you could call positive things, unless, of course, you're on the receiving end of that and she's working hard to destroy you and fighting against you. So I'm not entirely thrilled with those adjectives. But here's the other thing. Right now, in the Clinton truth suppression techniques, they're on number one with me, and I love that. It's my very favorite, because number one is to ignore me. And so I'm getting very little media coverage, very little anything. I've had a running battle with Amazon because they keep saying my book is out of stock or it's going to be shipped in 2 months. Or, you know, I went to number one on Amazon 2 months ago, still didn't get a number one sticker.
Sure. I mean, the fix
whatever.
Is in. They won't even list Donald Trump
like
as a political candidate on Google. So the answer is go to WND.com. Get the book directly from WorldNet Daily.
There you go.
Yeah, I would never even mention Amazon. I would say don't get it from Amazon, even though you made it number one. I just say go to WorldNet Daily. And I understand.
Yeah, and that's true. The thing of it is, Amazon is the 600-pound gorilla, and the 600-pound gorilla is one that does the accounting.
Oh,
and the
I know all about them.
So,
I know all
know,
about them. Yeah, we.
But I, you know, I'm over that. It's more important to talk to people like you. And wait a minute. I'm sorry. Back up. Nobody like you, Alex. But to talk to people on the radio and spread the word to those people who probably would never buy a book anyway. But we need to get the word out that Hillary is an other woman, and it's a play on words, because when I met her 15 years into knowing Billy, she was, if you will, the other woman. And then the flip side of that is, and why we have her facing away from the camera on the cover of the book, she is not the woman she would like you to think she is. She is an other woman.
Now let's talk about that. Who is Hillary Clinton from you knowing her so long? And, I mean, she knew you were with Bill sometimes? I mean, how was her attitude about that? Was it laissez-faire?
Well, she didn't really care what he did, as long as he didn't get caught in a way that would jeopardize her political career, because she, remember, was riding his coattails from the time she spotted him at Yale Law School and invited him to come and live with her, which Billy, I'm sorry to say, has always been something of a moocher. So, I mean, he told me in 1972 he was moving in with this law student, and it was really no big deal. And it really, it never was any big deal between us.
What about the word that she's really Webster Hubbell's daughter? She sure looks like him.
Yeah, I that's in my book. Robert Morrow, who wrote with my other friend Roger Stone the book Clinton's War on Woman, that women, they completely believe that Webb Hubbell is Chelsea's father. I don't think so, and I say my reasons in the book, but we agreed to disagree on that a long time ago until there's a definitive DNA test. I don't know. But if you're just looking at the big lip, go back and Google a picture of Dorothy Rodham, Hillary's mother, when she was Chelsea's age. Chelsea's a spitting image of her. And go look at a picture of Virginia Clinton when she was a young woman.
She looked a lot like her.
And she's got the big lower lip, too. So,
and, of course, do you think Bill, did Bill ever tell you anything about his mama? Because it was reported she was a lady of the night for the mafia.
Well, I knew Virginia. I mean, you got to remember, we grew up in Hot Springs. Our families were friends for years. Billy's Uncle Raymond.
But for those that don't know, that's I mean, that was still a big mafia party town then, though.
Well, yes, it was. But Virginia was an RN, and she was a nurse anesthetist. She was on call 24/7 for one period of about 3 years straight. And so she was always out and about. And I know that she had lots of affairs. And, that, you know, I mentioned Virginia in the book because she's just not the totally innocent party girl. And then I also talk about in the book where people say, well, a lot of guys, you know, quote, marry their mother, unquote, and they couldn't see a connection between Hillary, who is nothing like Virginia, and, you know, why? What did Billy see in her? And I talk about that in the book and go back to the fact that Hillary is his mean, controlling grandmother who raised him for the first 4 years. I was a psych major before I went to law school. You
I understand.
Know?
So let's expand on this. Expand on this. The word is, I think it was Clinton said it, that Hillary's seen more tail than a toilet seat or a bicycle seat. Is it? I mean, you know, Hillary's. Did you ever see any of her activity towards women?
No, and as I always say, I've heard the same things you've heard, but she never propositioned me. But I will say that in an interesting little incident that happened at the governor's mansion one night when I was with Billy, and I think I put this in the book too, that Billy said to me in a very intimate moment, I want to have a baby. And I was a little taken aback since we were both married to other people. And I said, do you think that's a good idea? And he looked at me sort of strangely, and then he kind of chuckled and he said, oh, I didn't mean with you. So, silver tongue.
Golly, I didn't mean with you, sweetheart.
Anyway, I said, what are you talking about? You don't have time to have a baby. Both of you are just crazy going in every direction. He said, we need to have a baby so that we will look like a normal couple, and we need to take away attention from the warden's lifestyle. He called her the warden.
I was about to say, that it's been reported they aborted a boy, and I guess they thought it'd be better for political purposes to have a girl. Did you ever?
I have no idea. No idea about that. And I also heard that Jennifer Flowers had an abortion of a baby with him. I don't know any more than you know.
All right. Well, listen, I'm going to read the book, and I want to have you back up before the election, obviously, for a full hour to take
call. Well, let me come down to Austin and do it in studio, because that's always more fun.
Let Nico Acosta know anytime you want to come down here. In fact, we'll fly you down here if you want to come down, have you in studio, put you in a hotel, and I would love to do that. And then maybe fly Roger Stone in or have him on as a guest while you're on, because he's an expert on this too. But in the 2 minutes we've got left, folks are going to get the book, but give us other tidbits about why you went public, why you're concerned, what you think Hillary will do once she's El Presidente if that happens.
I can't even think about that, Alex, without getting depressed or throwing up. So I'm not going to speculate on what happens if she's president. I'm going to say this. I have children. I have grandchildren. And I love my country. I still get goosebumps when we do the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag and sing the Star Spangled Banner. I love my country. Hillary hates America, hates Americans, hates everyone. Turn off the sound sometime when you're looking at a video of her and see the hate coming out of her eyes. I want to save my country for me, my children, my grandchildren, and everyone else is too, oh, by the way. But, you know, I'll admit to a selfish go. I want it better for my family.
You're right, though. When I see her, she's one of the most hateful people on a power trip.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's hard to march around like that. I march around like that for 1 minute when I'm mad at my kids, and they start asking me, Dad, what we do wrong, and I have to tell them to do their chores. I mean, she really radiates anger and hatred all the time. That's got to be exhausting.
Well, I think it is, and I think that's why she can't do what she needs to do. And you also know she cannot perform. She cannot have a press conference because she cannot answer questions. She is a volcano about to erupt. And as I said in Chapter 50, she's cognitively impaired. She just can't handle questions. If you think you could have asked her as many questions as you asked me and gotten as many answers, think again. She can't do it.
So she's getting more and more arrogant as it goes. If you've got to go, I understand we'll have you down in studio in the next few weeks. But
No. I'm good. You want to keep talking?
We'll just
good.
Do five more minutes on what you think she'll do with the nuclear launch codes and the buttons, because I know the Russians have psychoanalyzed her, and the Russians openly say, we don't normally get involved. We don't know about Trump, but Hillary is dangerous. We are scared of her. We'll be back. All right, a few more minutes with Dolly Kyle about how hateful Hillary is, but I've got CNN, MSNBC, and Fox News all on in the hallway, the break room, and the control room. And I went back to get some iced tea during the break, and it was every channel. Republicans withdraw support from Trump. He's in big trouble. And it's all the John McCain's, the George Herbert Walker Bush's, the establishment Republicans that you've seen over and over again that are basically Democrats that took over the Republican Party with the Rockefellers and others. And we've got all these GOP congressmen coming out and, quote, backing Clinton. This is the power structure that's been sharing power, openly revealing themselves. That's what Trump has forced them to do. And quite frankly, it's genius. Thank God the Republican establishment that lied us into the Iraq war and all this is against them. And they put up that horrible person onto CNN and onto MSNBC, like Al Sharpton up there, to tell us how Trump's bad. Over saying, what's this Muslim guy doing up there with his wife with a headdress on, not allowed to talk? Oh, you attacked a family. What about the ISIS cutting off millions of Christians' heads around the world, or hundreds of thousands in Syria? It's just crazy. So they're creating this whole illusion, as Matt was saying during the break, to make the Republicans look divided, so the average Republican thinks, I better vote for Gary Johnson, that quizzling of the Clintons, and that's what he's doing, when Trump's got to go to the Bernie people and get them on board. So it's all about people at home going, oh, I'm with the establishment, yeah, the bandwagon, yeah. Oh, I mean, thank God John McCain is against Trump. That's why you're for him. I mean, John McCain vacations and hangs out with the Clintons and hangs out with George Soros. I mean, give me a break. They think we're ignorant. Going back to Dolly Kyle for a few minutes, we're going to get her down here in studio in the near future. She wrote the book, Hillary the Other Woman, a political memoir, WNDbooks.com. What do you make of this whole attack piece that's taking place and the Republican establishment doing this? What's your view on Donald J. Trump?
I wish I knew Donald Trump better. When he started running, I didn't know anything about him, and I thought it was sort of a publicity stunt and a joke. Obviously, it is no joke. And I am amused watching the power structure, as you just talked. They are so afraid of him, and they're jealous. You know, these are men who are jealous of a real man with a spine and a backbone. And I think that a lot of people are not realizing that part of Trump's appeal is that John Wayne nature of his character. Like, I'm going to go in here and do what I believe is the right thing because I love America.
It's not a swagger. He's very confident, and it radiates.
Exactly. It really does. And there are very few men like that. And I think I wrote in this book something about if Republicans in Congress could have grown a collective spine, Donald Trump wouldn't have gotten anywhere. But Americans are sick.
That's right. He entered a vacuum where there's no men.
There are no men. It's like, where are the men? I guess they're in the transgender bathroom. I don't know where they are. But they're not running for office. They're not serving their country for the most part. There are a few exceptions. But it's like, what's in the water when they get to Washington? And this whole third party thing, I mean, if you don't learn from history, you're doomed to repeat it. This is not a country that works with third parties yet. And go back to 92. If Ross Perot had not run, Billy Clinton would not have run the won the election.
And let me go further.
Numbers.
When you have a John McCain.
So that third party disillusion of votes is what caused Clinton to get in. And the other thing is this. These 25 million Christians who sat home in 2012 because they couldn't vote for either of the candidates because they weren't good enough. Let me clue. I have read the Bible numerous times, including the book of Revelation. Jesus is not coming back to run for president of the United States, and therefore, people, we are always going to have flawed candidates. But I think it is morally and theologically imperative to vote for the candidate, the flawed candidate, who will do the most for the benefit of the country. And I'm not saying hand out the most stuff to the most people. I'm talking about the overall benefit of a country.
Sure.
And that means a place with borders. And by the way, everyone should go look on YouTube and see the video of Hillary in 2008 when she was campaigning saying, we need to enforce our borders. And if necessary, we need to build a wall in some places.
Great point. Earlier you said you didn't want to go to that nightmare scenario, but you started going there. The hatred Hillary has, the radiated aggression, the fact that she can't have press conferences. I mean, this is how a dictator operates. When you talk about her hatred and just saying, look at her, in your personal experiences, what do you think drives that? From what I've been told, and this was out years ago, it's now mainstream news, staffers can't look her in the eye. She never gives tips. She'll have a waitress fired if she looks at her. I mean, this is quite possibly a borderline personality disorder, psycho, egomaniac, narcissist. I mean, what would you call her?
Well, I will say this because of my own personal history and what I studied, and that was about sex addiction. Because when I was a 16-year-old virgin, just getting ready to go off to college, yes, at 16 because I skipped two grades, I was drugged and raped by one of Billy Clinton's friends. And that changed the trajectory of my life. People who have been raped generally tend to go toward promiscuity or frigidity. I went toward promiscuity. I realized I had a problem. I got a label on it. I got therapy. I talked to Billy Clinton about it. He admitted that he was a sex addict. And I'm going all the way around the bush to say this. I think Hillary was sexually molested by a woman, and I think she was sexually molested by a man. I do not think she has received any treatment. She does not understand anything about her own inner motivations. She hates the women per se who molested her and the men who molested her. And she looks in the mirror and she hates herself and she projects that. And I'm sorry, this is psychology 101. You don't even have to take 39 hours of it like I did to see what's going on with this woman.
I tell you, she acts very unstable and very, very dangerous. They keep saying Trump does. He's just a confident winner who, from all the women, they said he treats all the women really, really great and is a super big gentleman.
And I haven't met Donald Trump, but here's the thing. Hillary Clinton knew in 1974 that she was going to be riding Billy Clinton's coattails as far as she could. And from that moment on, everything she did was geared toward where she is right now, which is aiming at the White House. And so it was premeditated, intentional, every act that she committed, from shredding Marla Kreider's cute little notes and things that she sent to Billy when she was dating him at the University of Arkansas, shredding those, shredding the visitors' logs at the governor's mansion when they left so there was no record of me. Or
what about
them
stealing the silverware and George Washington's plates? I mean, these are kleptocratic people.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely they are. And, you know, I mean, we've kind of touched the tip of the iceberg here, and I hope we haven't ruined the story for anyone who's going to read it, but I think it's a pretty well-written book. I'm so happy, as of today, I have 350 five-star reviews of my book, and I'm pretty tickled with that.
Absolutely. Look, they don't want your book getting out. You're a very obviously smart, well-spoken lady. I can't wait to get you down here to Austin, Texas, and interview you here in studio. Dolly Kyle, thank you so much for spending time with us today.
You're welcome. It's fun, Alex. See you soon.
God bless. But he has a lot of courage, and she's on record photographed with Clinton, the whole nine yards. It's just all part of the whole paradigm. And, of course, they attack the person that's, you know, they're telling you the story. And she's saying, you know, Bill was nice to her. But she was raped by some of his friends, though. And you look at Hillary, something's wrong with her. I mean, I'm going to be honest with everybody. I'm not into victimology. I don't think I was sexually abused when I was 12 and 13 by 15, 16-year-old girls. I mean, I'm not bragging about being promiscuous when I was younger, but I'm owning that as being lucky. I'm not complaining about it because I was a man by then, or at least physically I was. But I can imagine other people in their psychology, somebody forcing something on them. And I guess it, you know, affects people in different ways. But if you're 13 years old and you're over at a girl's house and the 18-year-old sister comes back from college and throws you on the bed, I didn't think of that as rape. I can tell you right now, though, I know there are people that do, like, grab women and tie them up in a blanket and then, you know, really rape them, and that's terrible. But I'm just trying to understand what would make Hillary be so incredibly whacked out. What would turn her into this monster that's out to get everybody? Because the Clintons are just absolutely horrible people. And you talk to all the people that have been around them, the Secret Service agents, the FBI agents, the state police, all of them, they say Bill just wants to snort cocaine and have sex with 5-10 women a day. Occasionally he wants to rape a woman. If he wants them and can't have them, he'll do it later in life. But I mean, it was Hillary in there as the prime mover, selling the missiles, wanting the money, you know, making deals with the Russians. And it also seems like she gets off on being able to do whatever she wants. But I've talked to folks for decades about her at Bilderberg. And a lot of times we won't get any intel from people until after it's over, because Hillary's so rude and so hateful that she just absolutely wants to dominate and crush everybody. And because she grew up as kind of a Saul Alinsky acolyte who hates capitalism and wealth, despite the fact that she's in the middle of capitalism and stolen so much of it and lives on red carpets and on, you know, luxury jetliners, she still sees flyover country with your little four-bedroom house and your little swimming pool and your little gazebo and barbecue pit, you know, that she's going to show you. And she's going to take what you got. You know, so many people, I'm going to go to your calls, say, hey, we had a big boom under the Clintons. And it's true. In that economy, there was more of an economic boom than we've seen since then, because that was the end of the country. That's what the banksters do in Brazil or Chile or Nigeria or the hundreds of other countries they've done it in. They come in and they balloon the currency. They put the nation massively in debt. You're just getting a little bit of the money from the inflation and the trickle-down spending. The trillions in derivatives they're creating and the counterfeit, you're going to be signed on to it and you're going to be a slave. The big banks are getting the main benefit up front and throughout the process and in the bailout that came in 2008. And they admit the Clintons are the main authors of that, along with the Republican establishment. But I know this. Watching the Republican establishment come out and decry and put down Donald Trump and just much ado about nothing. And one time he made fun of someone who was disabled and then make that up. And oh my gosh, he said, what's this guy up here on TV with a woman with a hood over her head? I mean, you know, at a certain point, I can't go to Saudi Arabia and preach the gospel. They can shoot their mouth off about me all day and that's okay. But here it's like, oh no, you did something wrong. This is all, again, this much ado about nothing, creating this perception that Trump can't win and Trump's bad for all the little mindless followers to kind of get on the bandwagon. Well, here it is, Bernie supporters. You're able to talk and are pretty smart when we've talked to you. Hillary supporters can't even hardly talk. You got robbed. They say you didn't. Are you going to try to landslide this for Trump, who agrees with you on NAFTA and GATT? Hillary agrees with you on nothing. Hillary is horrible with every corrupt Wall Street interest there is. Donald Trump's old-fashioned blue-collar JFK type guy. I wouldn't even call the guy conservative. It's just like a throwback. I mean, what you're seeing is just an Americana. You know, a swaggering, you know, that's it. And he doesn't have it out to screw you. And he's always talked about globalists and big multinationals screwing him. He doesn't like them. They know that. They've got his MO. They are scared to death of him. And the guy is real. The guy is real. Really off the reservation. Let's play this Hannity clip that I'm going to. Here's another clip where he clarified and expanded on, yeah, it's a crooked system. Here it is.
You said in a speech today you're afraid this election is going to be rigged. Explain.
Yeah. Well, I've been hearing about it for a long time, and I know last time there were precincts where there were practically nobody voting for the Republican, and I think that's wrong. I think that was unfair, frankly, to Mitt Romney. You had areas where a lot of people were curious, how is that possible? And I've been hearing about it for a long time, and I just hope that there's really, I hope the Republicans get out there and watch very closely, because I think we're going to win this election. But if it's rigged, like anything else, look, it was rigged, I thought, a little bit for me, and we won in landslides. I think it was rigged against Bernie Sanders with his super delegates nonsense.
Absolutely. Well, we know it was rigged.
The guy never had a chance. And I'm telling you, November 8th, we better be careful, because that election's going to be rigged. And I hope the Republicans are watching closely, or it's going to be taken away from us.
That's right. And he's creating the narrative that is true, that she already stole the nomination from Bernie. And so you'd be insane not to comment on it. In fact, let's go to some calls, but I've got this clip. Bernie supporters now saying they're going for Trump. That's what this whole Republican shift is. This whole, they already betrayed Trump. They already tried to take him down. They already left him. I mean, I expect like every month they're going to leave Trump again. The same traitors, the same rhino Republicans are going to leave him every month because they think you have the memory of a goldfish. All these Republicans already signed a letter in the Weekly Standard. They already signed a letter in National Review. They already went out and did all this before. And they just think you're an idiot going, that's it, we're mad, we're leaving you, Trump. Insulting your intelligence. This one holding the longest here. It's Charles in Georgia. You're on the air worldwide. Go ahead.
It is a pleasure to be back on the show with you, talking to you again, General. I can't even remember the last time you and I spoke.
Well, good to talk to you, Charles. Good to hear your voice.
First of all, I would like to thank our U.S. service men and women for fighting to protect our First Amendment rights and all of our other freedoms as well.
Absolutely.
I'd like to thank you guys here at Infowars.com for helping other citizens, journalists out here like us and other people that you have on your show to get the truth out. Because if it wasn't for you guys, I don't know where we would be, and we wouldn't be able to get
Well, I want to be clear. It's all the smaller and medium-sized media that feeds the awakenings. You're just as important as InfoWars are.
Thank you so much for realizing that. And what I want to ask you, I wanted to make an announcement, but what I want to ask you first is if you have any, we agree with Trump down here in Georgia. I've gotten a lot of my friends and family members to subscribe to your YouTube channel and to listen to your show. And because I told him that's the only real news, Infowars.com, Matt Drudge, and the people that he has on the show. My question to you, before I make this important announcement to you guys, is do you have any additional information on 9/11 and the Saudi connection? Because we agree with Donald Trump. Donald Trump said that he was going to come out. And
Let me answer that after the break. But real quick, make your announcement. That's a big subject, 9/11. But go ahead.
My announcement is I have a powerful documentary film I would like to share with you guys at InfoWars and the InfoWars.
Sure, I've seen it. I forget your YouTube channel. We've linked to it before, but I remember your name, Charles. What's the name of your YouTube channel? And you got some viral videos.
My YouTube channel is Nation of Truth. You guys need to check that out. And we have Revealing the Mind of a Tyrant Part 2.
All right, we're going to... Peter Thiel, the billionaire Bilderberg Group member, the big star of the RNC. I don't think he's a bad guy for going to Bilderberg. I'd go if I was invited. He doesn't really promote globalism himself, but he does promote some New World Order stuff. He's come out, and he's obsessed with the blood transfusions that the elite have been doing for over 50, 60 years to try to live forever, live longer. I've got a special report that we're going to be airing tomorrow. Look for that. There's another article by Kit Daniels. It's very interesting on Infowars.com. Scientists, humanity faces great filter as early species in universe. Will we transcend the predatory elite to reach the stars? Kit Daniels. It's a journal of cosmology and aerosparticle physics. It deals with the fact that we live in a high radiation zone, and that as radiation dissipates in the universe, there'll be more life. It's just an interesting thing to look at and think about. Yeah, we live in an area so packed with radiation, you go outside, your skin burns. We are tough stuff, baby. And we are made by something even tougher. Ah, yes. The best laid plans of mice and men often go astray. Let's go ahead and take a few more calls. First off, I want to just say Paul Watson's doing the balance of the next hour. And he'll be co-hosting with David Knight tomorrow while I work on some important projects. But I've got some special reports that are going to be filed as well. They're going to be airing tomorrow. Briefly, we are having to end, obviously, the huge mega specials, the biggest in our history that were on all items, 40 to 20% off, depending on them, at InfoWarsStore.com. But we've kept three of the best sellers, the Vitamin Mineral Fusion, the Brain Force, the DNA Force, 40% off on Brain Force, 30% off on DNA Force, 30% off on Vitamin Mineral Fusion, and free shipping. Didn't have that during the super special. And we have a lot of other items as well. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. If you're not giving your kids, especially Vitamin Mineral Fusions, they actually absorb the vitamins and minerals and amino acids, you're crazy in my view. If you're not filtering your water, and we got the best systems, Alexa Pure and ProPure, I think you're crazy. Plus, you're funding this transmission, so I mean, it's a win-win-win from every direction. Where can you look anywhere in even mainstream media and see someone or an organization putting out talking points countervailing the establishment BS? We have a great responsibility here. I'm very honored to be part of it. That earlier caller had a question about 9/11. That is too big of a question to get into. The official story is not true. Criminal elements of our government that you see against Trump are allied with Saudi Arabia. And that attack was meant to take out Saudi's enemies, blaming Iraq for what Saudi Arabia was involved in. It's all part of a larger program. Let's talk to Warren in New Hampshire. Warren, thanks for holding her on the air.
Hey, Alex, how you doing? I've been listening to you since 97, 98. I first caught you on the shortwave, and I got your first video, America Destroyed by Design, which is a VHS.
Yes, sir. You made it all possible. You've been there since the start.
Yeah. What I was going to say is, because it's late in the game, because I've listened to you and done a lot of work on this myself, New World Order and how things run.
Oh, it's late in the game, isn't it? It's all admitted now.
Very late in the game. But I know that you're missing your point. Not you, but the whole movement in and of itself. You talk about, everybody talks about the New World Order, their power. They really don't have any power.
God has
the power. They get the money supply, and that's it, and that's where they derive their power. If you and Donald Trump would come out and just let the globalists know that we're going to change our money supply back to our control, which is going to change everything, you're going to see them post faster. I think that's the final nail in the coffin.
Well, here's the deal. Trump said he's taking the gloves off. He has. Obama and everybody's super scared. I guarantee you they're hovering over orders to kill him right now. They're deciding how to kill Trump right now. But they now have clicked that Trump's ready and prepared for that. The guy's incredible. I'm telling you, folks, Trump is amazing. He is ready to die. He's the real deal. He really is the real deal. We'll be right back. We have 5 more minutes, and I'm going to hand the baton. I wish people could get close to this evil once or twice, like Joel Skousen was talking about yesterday, and you'd never want to be part of it. All right, I want to play this clip and go back to your calls, and Paul Watson's coming up. There's a bunch of these videos. I want to play one that shows how much women who are Democrats hate Hillary. I mean, this is really them just installing their little bought and paid for princess. But we got another clip that shows how many Bernie supporters are planning to vote for Donald Trump. Here it is.
I'm Calvin Phillips, the Campus Reform. Today we're in Philadelphia at the DNC talking to angry Bernie protesters about whether or not they're going to be voting for Hillary in November or switching parties to vote for Donald Trump. Let's see what they have to say.
I was strong for Bernie, and now I'm taking the stand for Trump.
Okay. I'm going to use all of my time and energy to make sure Hillary doesn't win after the convention.
So in a swing state, you consider Trump?
Yes.
And do you think other Bernie supporters in swing states will consider voting for Trump to deny Hillary office?
I know they will. I know a lot of them, and they already said they will.
Had to vote for a Trump or Hillary, I'd pick Trump.
You say that you would possibly consider voting for Trump if the race were close. Do you think other Bernie supporters would do that?
Absolutely. You guys need to know.
It wouldn't be surprising to you to see a big chunk of the Bernie people go to Trump?
No, it wouldn't. And I have many intelligent peers within this movement who have said the same thing.
Some people that maybe Bernie is the person that they stuck with right now, but there are some things just anti-establishment, and they'll go with Trump to send that message.
I've posted on it on my social media, and quite a few people are going to go with Trump. Some people are sheep and they're going to fall in line and vote for Hillary.
As I spend time talking to Trump supporters, we agree on a lot of major issues that we're facing in this country. We're both mad about the same things.
Do you think other people like you are going to go to Trump?
I've heard that a lot of people are saying, they're saying to me, man, thank you for saying what I can't say yet.
I'm done with the Democratic Party.
So you've left the Democrat Party. Do you think that a lot of other Bernie supporters are going to do the same if they haven't already?
Yes, a lot have and a lot will after this convention.
If Bernie is not the Democratic nominee, then I will certainly leave the Democratic Party.
Do you think you'll leave the Democratic Party then?
Yeah. I mean, there's nothing Democratic about this.
I've already unregistered with the Democratic Party, so I think that should answer it.
As soon as I get back home, that's exactly what I'm going to do.
I can go back to the Democratic Party.
Okay. Do you feel like Hillary is trying to pressure women to vote for her just because she's a woman?
Oh, my God, yes. She is a con artist. She's a con artist, and she is definitely going to push that card.
You can't say, vote for me because I'm a feminist. Vote for me because I'm a woman, and just expect us.
She is not a feminist. She is not fighting for women. She never has, and she never will.
You colluded with her to win the election, and it's another slap in the face. It's why would we get in the party line after all of this?
I'm throwing this race to Trump.
And that's what every Bernie person I talk to says. They're either going to vote third party or for Trump. And again, I mean, I'm in the middle of Austin, the supposedly liberal. I've never really found any Hillary supporters unless it's down at the city council or the legislature about a bunch, you know, of rich people. I mean, that's it. You go in the richest areas of Austin, though, you will see the unicorn, which is the rare creature, the narwhal of the land. You will see Hillary signs. I have seen them in the twilight quickly driving by, but nowhere else. Nowhere. 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 And I've been all over the country. And that's why people are so angry and so upset. And that's why they've got this big fake split that the Republicans have all turned against him. They're all giving pledges to vote for Hillary. They were already saying they weren't for Trump. No surprise. Paul Watson from London, England is coming up. The InfoWars Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock Central Standard Time. Right here on the GCN Radio Network. I'm Alex Jones. Remember, they're trying to censor information. Get involved. Share our links, our videos. Create your own. Fight back. An epic war is taking place, and quite frankly, we're winning.
We're back for the fourth hour live overdrive of the Alex Jones Show with me, your host, Paul Joseph Watson. From somewhere in France, halfway up a mountain, via the wonders of modern technology, a laptop and a cell phone connection, I'm speaking to you. Have you heard the amazing, incredible, horrifying, disturbing new scandal about Donald Trump? Well, of course, the mainstream media, the establishment, can find absolutely nothing on him. They can barely find dirt under his fingernails. Meanwhile, crooked Hillary Clinton has a million skeletons in her closet. But we're not talking about that. We're talking about Donald Trump making a joke in front of a veteran where he said it was easier to get a purple star, a purple heart, if he was given one, rather than fighting for one in combat. Oh my God, how offensive. The scandal, the horror. This is out of the Daily Mail. Trump makes light of military sacrifice again when veteran gives him his purple heart. I always wanted to get the purple heart. This was so much easier. Now, bear in mind, the veteran who he was talking to on stage laughed at the joke. Laughed at the joke. But that's not good enough. Of course, everybody else has to get offended on his behalf. And this is the damning new evidence that Donald Trump hates the military. He made a lighthearted joke on stage with a veteran, and the veteran laughed at the joke. My God. This is a catastrophe for the Donald Trump campaign. However will he come back from this devastating blow to his credibility? God only knows. Meanwhile, Hillary Clinton has been exposed as being instrumental in selling weapons to jihadists and being instrumental in the rise of ISIS. But nobody's talking about that. Donald Trump made a joke about a medal on a stage. That's what the media is talking about. That's the big scandal. Of course, the other scandal is this, again, absolutely disturbing to the core. Breitbart reports panic mode. Kazia Khan deletes law firm website that specialized in Muslim immigration. Now recall, Kazia Khan, again, got up on stage at the DNC because Muslim gold star father, his son died in Iraq. And he went at Donald Trump for being a bigot, for being an Islamophobe, again, simply for making his comments on the fact that we need to vet thousands of immigrants that are coming in from countries such as Syria, where 21% of them support ISIS. Of course, that's racist, that's Islamophobic, that's bigoted to do that. Kazia Khan got up on stage, made this big play. Of course, the media picked up on it. This was the huge, massive new scandal that not only did Donald Trump hate Muslims, he also hates the military. No conversation whatsoever about how Hillary Clinton's own policies with regard to Libya led to the rise of ISIS, led to the international migrant crisis that just killed, you know, 200 more Muslims today trying to cross on a boat, that led to arming jihadists in Syria, those rebel factions that joined up with ISIS, who then killed tens of thousands of Muslims. We came, we saw, he died. Hillary Clinton did all that, not Donald Trump. Donald Trump made a remark about vetting immigrants coming into the country to prevent terrorism. Hillary Clinton's own policies directly led to the rise of ISIS, the international migrant crisis, and tens of thousands of dead Muslims. But who's worse? Of course, it's Donald Trump, because he said something that might be politically incorrect. My God. Kazia Khan, the Muslim gold star father that Democrats and their allies media-wide have been using to hammer GOP presidential nominee Donald Trump, has deleted his law firm's website from the internet. This development is significant, as his website proved, as Breitbart News and others have reported, that he financially benefits from unfettered pay-to-play Muslim migration into America. A snapshot of his now deleted website, as captured by the Wayback Machine, which takes snapshots archiving various websites on the internet, shows that as a lawyer, he engages in procurement of EB-5 immigration visas and other, quote, related immigration services. The website is now completely removed from the internet and instead directs visitors to the URL at which it was once page parking, the URL run by GoDaddy. So basically, this Kazia Khan has now been exposed as a complete hypocrite. He's got skin in the game. He's linked in with the Democratic establishment. He's linked in benefiting directly, financially, personally, from Muslim migration into America. This is the guy who got up on stage and said Donald Trump was an awful, terrible, evil person for suggesting, just for suggesting, that maybe it's a good idea to vet Muslim migrants coming into the United States when, you know, around 21% of them, in the case of Syrians, support ISIS. They've got beheading videos on their cell phones. They've got ISIS flags on their cell phones. We've got attacks every single frigging week in Europe by these refugees. Maybe it's a good idea to vet them. But no, Donald Trump's evil. Hillary Clinton, whose policies in arming jihadists in Syria, in attacking Libya, in overthrowing a secular government that led directly to the migrant crisis, to the deaths of thousands of migrants, that led directly to the rise of ISIS, who killed tens of thousands of Muslims, she's good with the Muslims. She's pro-Islam. She's politically correct because her policies led to the deaths of tens of thousands of Muslims. Donald Trump's evil because he said something about vetting immigrants to stop terrorists. That is the narrative the media is now trying to sell you. And oh my God, Donald Trump made a lighthearted joke on stage with a veteran, which the veteran laughed at and found funny. But no, we have to get offended on his behalf. That's terrible. Not only now does Donald Trump hate Muslims, he hates the military.
Again, they've got absolutely nothing on him. Meanwhile, Crooked Hillary, thousands of skeletons in the closet. Nobody even wants to talk about it in the media because, of course, they're in the tank for Hillary. Another thing they don't want to talk about, which I'm going to talk about and I'm going to make a video about, is Hillary Clinton's bizarre behavior. Now, you must have seen the video which we posted back about 10 days ago, 2 weeks ago. Hillary Clinton reacting to a question from a reporter. She goes off in this bizarre bobblehead procedure. It looks like she's having a seizure. She tries to recover it. It looks absolutely incredibly bizarre. A few days ago at the DNC, the same thing. Now, I don't know what happened. They must have released some balloons or something above their heads, but it was Hillary and Bill Clinton on stage, and she suddenly catches sight of whatever's above her, and she literally looks like a three-year-old, dazzled by balloons, completely in her element, eyes darting from side to side, completely out of it. What is going on with Hillary Clinton? We know in 2012 that she had this blood clot in her brain. We know that she collapsed. We know that she had seizures. If you look at the medical information about this cerebral venous thrombosis, which is the blood clot in her brain, 43% of people who have that, who suffer that, go on to have difficulties, again, with cognition, with balance, with having seizures. Remember, this is a woman who constantly claims that Donald Trump is unfit to be president. Of course, she's talking about his policies, his rhetoric. She could be physically unfit to be president. We've had memory problems. We've had the whole, you know, Bosnian sniper fire lie that she completely made up out of whole cloth. We've had reports, again, from her Secret Service, more recently from her own campaign insiders, who told the New York Post that Clinton has, quote, been screaming and having childlike tantrums that have left staff members in tears and unable to work. Quote, we're having some success in giving her some chill pills. What kind of pills is Hillary Clinton on at this point? We've had gaffes. We've had her being, you know, unable to remember things. We've had these ridiculous coughing fits, which again is another side effect of having a stroke. Garbled voice, choking, coughing. If you look at the medical information surrounding this issue, motor neuron difficulties, myoclonic seizures, jerking of the eyes, head, or arms, reflex epilepsies may occur at any age. Again, these are consequences of this brain clot that she had back in 2012. Are we now starting to see the results of that? She refuses to take a press conference. Again, there's speculation that these seizures, these tics, whatever they are, which are completely bizarre, as you can see in the videos, could be triggered by people talking, by multiple numbers of people talking around her, which is exactly what we saw with one of the most recent videos. Again, she refuses to do press conferences where you're being bombarded with people talking to you. Interviews, and the ones that she does do are heavily scripted. Very bizarre behavior with Hillary Clinton. I'm talking to psychiatrists and psychologists to try and get a wider perspective on this. But she claims Donald Trump is unfit for office because of his policies. Could she be physically unfit for office? We'll be back with the Alex Jones Show live, breaking news at Infowars.com. Don't go. We are back on the 4th hour overdrive of the Alex Jones Show, and I need to tell you about our specials at Infowarsstore.com. We've had to pull most of them from the Operation Sleeping Giant Super Sale fundraiser last week, but we have extended some of the key specials at Infowarsstore.com. Now, why do you need to get the products? Well, if you really want us to uncover the next AIDS Skrillex, the next Carl the Cook, even maybe the next Triggly Puff, then this is what funds us. Of course, compare InfoWars now to InfoWars, you know, 4 or 5 years ago. We didn't have the resources nor the staff to send people out to cover events. Again, it's amazing how much the team, just in terms of numbers alone, has grown, you know, over the past 5, 6 years. When it started out, it was basically Alex, a lady on the phones doing sales, a website operator, and me, and that was it. It was basically a handful of people. Look at it now. It's a behemoth. And we're challenging the mainstream media directly. That's the point. We're able to send people out to all these events to get the violent, radical, unhinged social justice warriors on camera to shine a light, to shine a mirror in their direction, to prove exactly how extremist they are. This is absolutely vital to derailing the mainstream media narrative. You see now, trust in mainstream media at record lows, people turning away from television, people turning away from print media. It's because, to a larger and larger extent, we are taking their place. And that's because of you getting the products at InfoWarsStore.com. We simply couldn't do it without you. We couldn't pay the hotel bills. We couldn't pay the flight costs. We couldn't pay for the equipment. We couldn't hire the staff in the first place to do this. This is why it's so important for you to continue supporting us at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, we've got 40% off Brainforce. Again, this is a nootropic that I've personally taken. Again, jet lagged, 3 hours sleep flying across the Atlantic Ocean. Had to host a 3-hour radio show. Brainforce. Took 2 pills. Absolutely dynamic, laser precision, cognitive focus. This is what it gives you. And I've tried some of the other similar products like Alpha Brain, which are decent, but nothing compared to this. Brainforce. If you're doing any kind of mental work whatsoever, this is really going to help you out. It's helped me personally. It's helped Rob Dew and several other people in the InfoWars office. This actually works. This actually works to fire the neurons in your brain. It's not like caffeine. It's not some mad rush. It's a calm, focused effect. It helps you work. It helps you think. So we got 40% off Brainforce at InfoWarsStore.com. And again, it all goes back into the operation. It fires us up to take on the mainstream media, to derail their narratives on a daily basis. So support us by getting the products at InfoWarsStore.com. Final couple of minutes before the break, we got a headline out of CNS News. Syrian refugees admitted to US in FY16, only 35 Christians. The Obama administration admitted 2,340 Syrian refugees into the United States in July, almost as many as the record number of admissions in June, 2,406, keeping it on track to reach its goal of 10,000 by the end of September. So you look at the percentage of Sunni Muslims and Christians in July. 98.6 of the Syrian refugees admitted into the United States were Sunni Muslim, compared to 0.6% Christian. Now, if you look at the population of Syria, even as it is now, even after the civil war, it's still 10% Christian. Why aren't 10% of the Syrian refugees coming into the United States, and coming into Europe for that matter, why aren't they Christian? Why is it overwhelmingly Sunni Muslims? We also have the DHS, again in this story a couple of days ago, agreeing to grant amnesty to 8,000 Syrians. Now again, 21% of Syrians, according to a poll, and I've featured this in my videos before, this is not in a right-wing newspaper, this is an independent Ipsos poll of Syrians, 21% of whom said they support ISIS. So again, of these 8,000 Syrians that the DHS is granting amnesty, in this one program alone, not to mention the others coming in, statistically, over 1,500 of those people granted asylum by the DHS support ISIS. But Donald Trump's evil for saying we should have more strenuous vetting. We'll be back with the Alex Jones Show Live Overdrive. Don't go away.
It's the Alex Jones Show, 4th Hour Overdrive. And I forgot to mention before, at InfoWarsStore.com, we've got free shipping on everything throughout the entire week. So every order you make this week, for this week only, free shipping on all the products at InfoWarsStore.com. Again, we've extended the following mega specials: 40% off Brain Force, 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion, 30% off DNA Force, and again, store-wide free shipping at InfoWarsStore.com. Cannot emphasize enough how incredibly important it is for you to support us by getting the products at InfoWarsStore.com. It makes absolutely everything possible. Free shipping all week at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, this is becoming a regular segment on this show for me. It's Death Threat of the Week. Now, I received this message again. More friendly words from the Religion of Peace, from a guy called Muhammad, surprisingly enough, who tells me, "I am a proud British Muslim white male. And you know what? I find what you say about Islam offensive. And soon those words will be your last." Because this is the Religion of Peace, of course. "We Muslims do not forgive easily. We will soon take over your lands, and your women belong to us all." I'm actually correcting his typos here because it's replete with them. "Your white man will have only but one choice, join or die. Soon you will pay for your hatred towards Islam. Your hateful nature will be met with Allah's wrath." Then he quotes a bunch of passages out of the Quran, out of the textbook of the Religion of Peace, which talk about how they're going to kill all the infidels because it's a religion of peace. Again, don't you dare say that Islam is not a religion of peace. We're going to prove you wrong by killing you. He finishes the message by saying, "Your time will soon come. We Muslims will have our day, and yours will come to an end." So again, that is a friendly message from the Religion of Peace. But it's just a tiny minority of extremists, nothing to worry about. Just ignore those polls which show, you know, like 35% of Muslims in France, where I am right now, support suicide bombings. Just a tiny minority. Again, the Religion of Peace. Going back to the news, though, of course, I'm here in France, which experienced another bout of cultural enrichment last week with the slaying of the priest. In fact, what I've heard since I arrived here is, to a large extent, even more shocking. Now, of course, we had the story yesterday on Infowars.com about a car bomb in London. Apparently, there was an attempt at a car bomb attack in Camden in London on Saturday night at peak time, where you've got thousands of people milling around, going to bars, going to clubs. A member of the public reported a suspicious vehicle. The police soon arrived and declared that it was a false alarm after having evacuated the entire area. Well, of course, somebody who worked at one of those venues told me directly that he had a conversation with the general manager, who was close with the police, who told him it was a car bomb. There was shrapnel in there. There were gas canisters in the car. The car was unregistered, no tax. It was a terrorist attack that they covered up. You could say, well, that's perfectly reasonable. They don't want to cause panic. But again, it happened in Germany. Remember the police officers, the paramedics who reported bombs in a fake ambulance outside a soccer stadium. They evacuated the stadium, but later said again that it was a false alarm. The police said it was real and that they were ordered not to talk about it. So in addition to all the attacks that you see across Europe, we're also having attacks, apparently, that are being covered up by the authorities. Now, it gets even more insane with this. Again, I'm here in France. My parents run a guest house. My mother teaches English to people from all across France, many of them in significant positions in corporations, in governments, also people around Europe. Now, she was told directly by one of her students that Muslim migrants, these newly arrived Muslim migrants, because of course we've always had problems with integration. In the past, the Muslims would, you know, largely refuse to integrate, but they would still keep themselves to themselves. Now we're seeing a new breed of Muslim migrants
And she was actually told by this individual who works for a mayor in a town here in France that newly arrived Muslim migrants are going to government offices and threatening to kill family members of local government officials if they're not given jobs. You might say, well, that's horrible. Of course, the government officials there at the mayor's office must have immediately called the police, reported this terroristic threat. After these Muslim migrants threatened to kill members of their family if they didn't give them jobs. Well, what happened was they gave them the jobs. Absolutely unbelievable. They actually are giving jobs to Muslim migrants who threaten to kill their family members. Now, you talk about France's history of submission, of fealty. We saw after Charlie Hebdo, after the Paris massacre, you know, hug a Muslim. Still, to this day, we see the Prime Minister, Manuel Valls, saying the French just have to live with terrorism. He came out yesterday and said the French government is still more concerned about right-wing populists than Islamic terrorists. So again, this is complete capitulation. Michel Houellebecq wrote about it in his book Submission, where he foresaw a future where Islamists would take power in government and take over that way. We're seeing capitulation, not in novel form, but in real life, actually threatening to kill family members of local officials if they're not given jobs and then being given jobs. And this is equally insane. You saw the story we covered last week out of Breitbart and other sources, where in Germany, their culture is to have nude swimming pools. So these Muslim migrants walk up to women in these swimming pools, start screaming Allah Akbar in their faces and threatening to, quote, exterminate them because it's a religion of peace, etc., etc. Now you think, well, this is horrible. Some swimming pools in European countries have had to introduce segregation to deal with this. This is a massive issue. Well, the solution in France to Muslim migrants harassing women in swimming pools, not to mention all the cases where Muslim migrants have gone into swimming pools and raped children and not even tried to flee the scene because it's just part of their culture. Muslim migrants going to swimming pools, harassing women. The solution in some places in France, this is what I was told. There's no reason to believe that anyone would make this up. So they harass women at swimming pools, sexually assault them in some cases. The solution from local governments in France is to give these migrants jobs as pool attendants. No, this is not a story out of The Onion. They're actually rewarding the migrants who harass women at swimming pools with jobs as pool attendants, as lifeguards, to help integrate them. And the individual who spoke to us about this also said, most of these migrants can't even swim. So not only are they rewarding them for harassing women at swimming pools, by giving them jobs, they're actually putting those women in even more danger, not merely because of the sexual harassment, but because these migrants can't even swim. They can't even do the job. Absolutely insane. I talk to women across Germany on Facebook. They send me messages saying that basically sexual harassment by migrants, which of course we saw on a mass scale in Cologne and Hamburg on New Year's Eve, we saw it in Sweden with the music festivals recently. One woman in Germany told me, basically, sexual harassment by migrants is, quote, now part of my daily life. Bearing in mind, this is a woman who was left-wing. She was a campaigner for refugees welcome. Well, not so much now. Because she says every single day, whether it be a bus terminal, the train station, walking down the street, harassment, sexual harassment by migrants is now a daily part of her life. We had a story out of the UK from The Express. Police arrest 900 Syrians in England and Wales for crimes including rape and child abuse. Okay, we've admitted 1,600 refugees from Syria into the United Kingdom over the past year. Of course, there would have been some Syrian migrants already here before that time, but probably not that many. So out of 1,600 that we've admitted over the last year, and whoever was here originally, 900 of them have been arrested already for crimes including rape and child abuse. Absolutely astonishing. The media won't talk about it. They will talk about someone being mean to a Muslim on a bus, and that becomes part of the narrative for the next 2 weeks. Oh, a massive hate crime wave sweeping the United Kingdom. Meanwhile, we have an actual crime wave sweeping the entire continent, and they daren't talk about it because it's not politically correct. You've got German police covering up crimes involving migrants, admittedly. You've got the head of the top broadcaster in Germany, ZDF, saying, we don't report on migrant crimes, we report what the government tells us to report. So if you imagine just the crimes, the colognes, the Hamburgs, the rapes at the Swedish festival. Oh, and by the way, another 14-year-old girl and another woman raped by migrants in Sweden just over the past few days, cultural enrichment intensifies. These are just the cases that we hear about. Given that there's a massive cover-up, imagine all the cases that we don't hear about. This is absolutely astonishing. But from one form of extremism to another, you may have seen this on my YouTube channel, this is the 20-year-old woman who lives her life as a baby. Let's roll the clip. 21-year-old Jess from Florida has dedicated her life to living with her boyfriend as a baby. She says she wears diapers, but only pees in them. No poo-poo.
I don't know, like, that's just too far for me.
Right, because rolling around in a nappy while pissing yourself is perfectly within the bounds of normality.
For me, there is nothing sexual about my age play or anything like that.
Really? Is that why your YouTube header image is you with your legs spread wide open with the camera centered on your crotch? No, that's not sexual at all.
Oh, they call me a pedophile. Age play is not sexually stimulating to me in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah, right. So it's not a sexual thing, but the official terms for what you get up to are daddy dominant slash little girl, adult baby diaper love, and age play. All subsects of BDSM, which for those who don't know, stands for bondage, dominance, submission, and sadomasochism. Yep. Nothing sexual about that.
I think all kinds of people watch my videos for different intentions or purposes.
Pedophiles. Jess says that living as a baby is a way of dealing with her being sexually abused as a child, but admits that she would probably have chosen the lifestyle anyway. Okay, two things here. One, the fact that adult babies are even a thing is part of the regressive left's demented attempt to normalize pedophilia as a legitimate alternative sexual preference. Remember this middle-aged freak who abandoned his wife and seven kids to live as a six-year-old girl. You may laugh, but many on the left celebrated Stephanie Walsh as a brave icon for the transgender community. Remember Todd Nickerson, the wannabe child molester who has a regular platform with Salon.com, who illustrated him talking about masturbating over a five-year-old girl by romanticizing it with dreamy footage of a child dancing and twirling, who continue to give Nickerson a platform despite him admitting he would, quote, engage in sex play with a child if she wanted it and initiated it.
Because their agenda here is sabotage. It started out maybe as creative destruction. Let's tear it down and then rebuild society in our own image. But now it's just, you know what, screw rebuilding. Let's just blow it up.
And secondly, baby Jess has her coloring book. But coloring books aimed at adults are now a thing. They're marketed as stress relievers. In reality, this is one aspect of a wider trend, the infantilization of society as a whole. Social media has had the effect of creating this endless compulsion for validation, regressing us back to the mindset we had as toddlers. The baby's narcissistic need for someone to constantly reassure it that it exists. According to leading neuroscientist and professor of synaptic pharmacology at Lincoln College, Oxford, Lady Greenfield, social media is exacerbating short attention spans, narcissism, and the inability to empathize. All traits associated with infants. We're creating drug addicts who are so addicted to screen time that they devote zero effort to forming their characters in the real world. This leads to a constant state of identity crisis, which is why we see this explosion of young people identifying as all kinds of nebulous and bizarre things. We're being trapped in a state of permanent adolescence. Thanks to social media, young people's brains are being rewired. You've now got grown men and women walking off cliffs trying to catch animated Pokemon characters, for God's sake. You've got adults wanting to suck on dummies, piss in diapers, and pretend they're babies. In the decadent late stages of a society, bizarre and aberrant behavior becomes commonplace. So commonplace that the mass media and many on the left embrace and promote it as normal.
And I found, okay, in my study, that history is cyclic. And everywhere in the world, you find this pattern, okay, in ancient times, that as a culture begins to decline, you have an efflorescence, okay, of transgender phenomena, okay? That is a symptom of cultural collapse. So rather than people singing the praises of the humanitarian liberalism, okay, that allows all of these transgender possibilities, okay, to appear and to be encouraged, I would be concerned about how Western culture is defining itself to the world.
As another example, a top professor of clinical psychiatry even said that this woman having someone pour drain cleaner in her eyes so she could become blind was an ethical way of treating her condition. Yes,
okay,
we've always
we'll leave
had
it
humans
there. Again, this is about the externalization of the vulgar. This is a deliberate program to brainwash everybody, to infantilize our minds. We'll be back with the final segment of The Alex Jones Show. Breaking news at Infowars.com. Stay right there. Segment of the Alex Jones Show Overdrive. I'll be back co-hosting with David Knight tomorrow. Again, to recap those specials, Infowarsstore.com, 40% off Brain Force, 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion, 30% off DNA Force, and we've got store-wide free shipping all week, Infowarsstore.com. Huge article up on Infowars.com, red linked at the top. Trump is right. Hillary stole the nomination and she will try to steal the presidency. Once again, the establishment, the mainstream media is out saying, oh my God, Donald Trump said that Hillary's going to rig the election. What a bizarre, unfounded, baseless conspiracy theory. But actually, he's just voicing objectively provable facts. The fact that she rigged the whole primary process. We don't even need the leaked, you know, WikiLeaks DNC emails to tell us that. We had the New York Daily News. This was way back in March, admitting the Democratic Party nomination is largely controlled by, quote, the desire of party bosses who don't have to take into account the expressed desire of Democratic voters. In other words, the voters who voted for Bernie Sanders, whose votes counted for nothing. Again, they asked these superdelegates, what's going to happen if Bernie Sanders wins? They said brazenly, we're still going to support Hillary Clinton. It was rigged from the very beginning. The New York Daily News, which is a left-leaning newspaper, said themselves that it was rigged way back in March. Again, we've got the leaked DNC emails, the Democratic Party establishment conspiring to choose to pre-select Hillary Clinton before the primary process even started. In what world is that not rigged? Trump is completely right. The fix was in from the start. Even many on the left who aren't Bernie Sanders supporters admit that. So to claim that his concerns about the election itself being rigged are a baseless conspiracy theory is completely
and utterly incorrect. Once again, Trump is completely right to voice these concerns. It's happened before. Why wouldn't it happen again, especially given how crooked Hillary Clinton really is? So that's a really important article up on Infowars.com. Get that, get it out to people. Continue with this narrative that Hillary is planning to rig the election. And again, the other aspect, what is wrong with Hillary Clinton? Is it just a tick? Is she suffering seizures? Is she going to have a stroke? Does she have brain damage? This bizarre behavior, this medical history attached to Hillary Clinton, these bizarre coughing fits. Again, I'm going to put all that together in a video coming up over the next couple of days, but let's hit on a final few news stories. We've got Corinne Gaines, Black Lives Matter's latest poster child, who basically abducted a child, pointed a gun at cops, shot at cops, said, quote, "If you don't leave, I'm going to kill you," during a standoff. They shot her dead. She's the latest poster child for Black Lives Matter, which of course is no surprise given that they exalted, you know, Antonio Martin, who pointed a cop at a gun's head, as an icon. Michael Brown, the thug who tried to grab Officer Darren Wilson's gun, who charged at him, he's their big poster child. Alton Sterling, the convicted sex offender, who again tried to grab an officer's gun as he resisted arrest. We've seen yet another case of that. With Corinne Gaines, that's their new big poster child. The racial division will continue. That's going to wrap it up for this edition of The Alex Jones Show. I will be back with David Knight tomorrow at 11 a.m. Coming up tonight, InfoWars Nightly News. Thanks for joining us. Breaking news at InfoWars.com.